The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good morning, Minnesota social workers. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. My name is Karen Goodenough. I'm executive director of NASW Minnesota, proud social worker, and thrilled to have over, let's see, it looks like we're at just over 600 attendees with us right now, and it's growing every second. We have about 800 plus folks registered this morning, so a few more will join us. Just a quick note that if you do have to hop off at some point this morning, we are going to be recording this session and we will put it up on our YouTube channel so you can jump in later and watch whatever you missed or share it with your friends or colleagues that missed the day as well. So thanks again for being with us for Social Work Day at the Capitol 2020, which is now Social Work Online Advocacy Day. This has been a wild process, let's say that. We all know that there's a lot going on in the world, and when you plan an event for over 1,000 people and then can't do it in the way that we planned, as you can imagine, there's a lot of work that goes into making that happen. So I want to just send a quick shout out right away this morning to our committee members, Shireen Retta, our chapter coordinator, Lauren Abdil, Danny Stokes, Sarah Huffman, and Donna Rubio, for all of the work that they did to make Day at the Capitol really awesome, and now to shift it into a really fantastic online advocacy day. So Social Work Day at the Capitol is one of my very favorite days of the year. As I said, normally we have about just over 1,000 people. We would be at the River Center this morning. We will be there next year. And then we normally head over to the Capitol for a rally and then some time with our legislators. And as you can imagine, some of you have been with us before, so welcome back. Others, this is your first time. Social Work Day at the Capitol is a really special day. As I've said many times over the last couple of years, this is not student Social Work Day at the Capitol, this is Social Work Day at the Capitol. So this is both students, so a lot of our schools use this as an opportunity to bring their students to the Capitol often for the first time, to start to get to know legislators, to start to kind of see how the process all works. But this is an opportunity for all social workers to sort of work that angle of our code of ethics that says that we're all called to do advocacy work on behalf of our colleagues. And for most social workers, I would venture to say all, this is absolutely not the day that we do advocacy work. This is one day that we happen to do advocacy work and where we come together to hear some collective things and then we move some things forward together. But really, social workers, as we all know, are called in our code of ethics, and we're trained in our programs to learn how to do advocacy work and to do it every day on behalf of our clients and to talk with our legislators, lawmakers, decision makers throughout the year all the time as needed. So this is just our one big day to work on these things together. So a couple of housekeeping things. Everyone is muted. So as you can tell, you should be only hearing my voice this morning so far. When you do have a question, you'll have in your little screen on the side, there's a little chat drop down, and you can click that chat drop down and put in any questions that you have. Lauren Abdil, who's one of our board members and is our committee chair, will be fielding all of your questions. And as each of our presenters finishes, she will be sharing your questions back with the presenter and I so we can answer them. So please use that chat as you have questions for us. Also, if you have any tech questions, if something doesn't happen to be working correctly, you can use that as well. You'll also be hearing from Shireen and Lauren throughout the presentation. Thank you for the reminder, Shireen. I'm using all my screens here, including my phone, and Shireen tells me it's time to go to the next slide. So here we are. Here are your important notes. You've got your chat box. There's a little GoToWebinar connection trouble if you're having that. And then just a reminder to stick around at the end. Some of you are looking for your CEUs. So if you are collecting those CEUs, which now can all be done online for this round, your next 2 years for licensure. At the end of the morning, we will give out information on CEUs. We'll have some prizes that we'll be giving out for advocacy work that folks will do today and in the next coming days. So at the end of the session, we will give you that info. Here's just a quick overview of the day. In just a couple of minutes, we're going to hear from Heather Edelson. She's a Minnesota House of Representatives member from 49A and is a social worker, and we're thrilled to have her with us this morning. Starting at 9:35, we'll hear from three policy partners, Marie Ellis from the Minnesota Council of Nonprofits, Sue Abderholden from NAMI, and Susie Emmert, who is from Hennepin Healthcare. As you can tell, you know, we can't hear from everyone every day at the Capitol, and we definitely can't hear from everyone on our online advocacy day. So this morning, we've chosen a few of our policy partners who are working on things that, from what we hear from social workers, are definitely sort of the most important things generally for all social workers, but there may be things that you don't hear this morning that you're interested in as well, and we'll give you a bunch of more information about where some resources are and that sort of thing. Just a heads up, you should have received a link to a Google Doc that has all kinds of folders in it with materials for this morning, and we will refer back to that several times. And there's some things from each of these policy partners organizations and then from several others as well. And then at around 10:30, we'll hear from Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan, which we're really excited to have Peggy with us this morning. Around 10:40, you'll hear from a couple of our team members on everyday advocacy training. So really some simple kind of how to do this work and to refresh people who've been doing it and to give an update to those who maybe haven't done this stuff in a while too. And then around 11 o'clock, and don't hold us to that, so somewhere around 11, 11:15, we will turn you loose and ask you to go and do some advocacy work. So we're going to talk about a lot of things this morning, we'll give you a bunch of resources, and then we're going to ask you to actually do some advocacy today. So that's why we said the event goes from 9 to noon. We wanted you to hold some time, precious today, to actually do some of that work. So you might send some emails, you might post to Facebook or Twitter, or Instagram or Snapchat or whatever things you use in the world. You might make some phone calls to legislators. Any of those things could be in your individual advocacy time. And it doesn't have to end at noon. We just wanted to make sure that you held a chunk of time today. All right, and with that, we are going to move to our first speaker of the morning. As Heather comes on here with us, we want to, we've invited Heather to be sort of our opener this morning, because it's really important to hear kind of exactly what's happening at the Capitol right now. Things are a bit strange, as you can imagine, with our legislators trying to do their work remotely. My understanding is that the legislature is back in session today. So this morning we've invited Minnesota House of Representatives member Heather Edelson. She's an LGSW from Edina. She grew up in North Minneapolis and is a first generation college graduate, mother, mental health therapist, and an avid community leader. She spent years as an outpatient mental health therapist and a guardian ad litem for child protection cases in Hennepin County, advocating for child's rights in court proceedings. So I want to welcome Heather, and thanks so much for joining us this morning. I hear that the legislature is reconvening today. I'd love for you to tell us to start with, what does that look like for the legislature to reconvene, and what has your work looked like at the Capitol over the last couple of weeks? And Heather, I think you should be able to go ahead.
Yes, thank you. Yay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So rates, yes, today we are reconvening at 12 o'clock today. We'll be going to, you know, so funny that we're all there. A group of us will be going to St. Paul because they want us in St. Paul, but not necessarily going inside the chamber. So if you've been to the Capitol, we all convene in the Minnesota House chamber. Well, right now with social distancing, that's not possible. So a lot of us have been right outside near our cars. We've gone into like the parking lot of the state office building and social distanced, but wow, also been on our phone. And so we did pass a special rule allowing that to happen. And so that is what we are doing today. But we're voting on a COVID bill that will bring some relief around several different areas. But it's not going, I mean, we keep making these little tweaks. But, you know, one thing that I will say is, you know, there's still areas that we haven't addressed, and none of this is perfect. I think legislators, the governor, all of us
Heather, I think your mic is going in and out just a little bit. I don't know if some place you are in your house is clearer than others potentially. And I think it's possible we lost Heather.
Here we go. Nope, I got you. I can hear you.
There we go. Okay, great. Thanks. So you were saying that, things are definitely looking different. And you were talking a little bit about what it is you're working on right now. You're planning to pass some kind of additional COVID bill today.
Yeah. There's a bill that we're looking to pass today. The insulin bill, which we have an agreement on, so that will be up first, which I mean, I'm sure many of the people on the call right now have heard about that. We do have a agreement between the Senate and the House on that bill. So that is good news. That will be passed first, and then we're going to be looking at more modifications and relief in terms of the COVID legislation. But what I was saying is you know, as we're learning more and more, it's just challenging because there are so many people we're not meeting the needs of. And I think as a social worker, I think your point about advocacy being very built in, we still don't have, say, you know, we have a moratorium on evictions. Well, great, but that doesn't provide people with relief on their rent. So, or it doesn't go to the other thing, you know, making sure that mortgages, like there's relief for the rent, that, you know, a lot of times landlords have mortgages too. So it's looking at that entire picture. People want to be able to pay their rent. Like I grew up to a single mom. We lived paycheck to paycheck, and my mom wanted to pay her rent. People want to do that, but it's not just you can't evict me. People want to have solutions. And so that, you know, that's one frustrating area for me right now that I think that we could do better on. We also have a bunch of independent contractors in the state of Minnesota. They don't qualify for unemployment. The federal government has not released the disaster unemployment. So we're telling them to apply, but they haven't gotten anything yet. So that's also another front. So what do you do if you're a parent and your job is a hairstylist and all of a sudden this virus hits? What do you do? And we don't have as many options as we should.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, Heather, I think what's been tricky for us at NASW, I think is hard for all social workers in different areas of practice, is that this situation currently hits every individual so differently. And our work lives, our home lives, you know, depending on how old your kids are, what kind of space you live in, the kind of work setting you have. I mean, there's so many variables. So I can imagine that your job in trying to pass laws that meet everyone's needs can be really difficult. It's a hard job you have. So we appreciate everything that you are doing. Can you give us a sense of how long you think the session will go?
It's right now we have the date today, but it's honestly, we don't know right now. I think it really depends. We will end probably as we thought we were, which is in May, but I think we'll come back for a session. So there's just rules on how we do it. But with that, I think it really depends. Now, I think a lot of people have heard about the antibodies tests are coming out more now. And so we're trying to figure out what does the path, like that's a part of getting us possibly out, and people, if they have immunity, getting them back into the community, back into the workforce, trying to figure out what this looks like. I think everybody wants answers, but this is evolving. And the one thing I learned a few weeks ago is to never try to guess too much about how things are going, because with COVID-19 and how this has all gone, it has, honestly, it's not predictable. So it is very challenging. Though I will tell you, I've been reading this book, The Psychology of a Pandemic, which has been super interesting. So if any of you out there order this, it's from Oxford. So it took a few days to get here. but really interesting to see the process. I think social workers really just want to understand how things are working. The book is really helpful. It was helpful in how do people internalize what a pandemic is? Yes, we know that it can cause PTSD. Yes, we know it causes anxiety. But what else does that look like for people in terms of after you've been quarantined or in your house for so long, how do you start to interpret rules? And it ends up being very different. I mean, it talks about, it's, you think about like right now in a population, so whether or not we have a vaccine. So we know that 30% of people right now in the state of Minnesota, actually across the US, only get shots, vaccinations in general. So if you have a vaccine, they found is that not everybody gets it. Only about 40% of people do. So isn't that interesting? I mean, it's just interesting things.
Mm-hmm. I love what you're highlighting for me, Heather, is one of the things we wanted to touch on this morning is this notion that our legislators are still learning through this whole thing. And it sounds like you are finding some resources to help you understand and make sense of what data is out there, that sort of thing. But I think that, you know, we have really high expectations of our lawmakers to know a lot, to make decisions rather quickly, to make the right decisions. And I think what you're talking about is this notion that you don't all know exactly how this is going to go, how it should go, what exactly you need to do, that sort of thing. So I appreciate your candidness in that side of it as well. When you think a little bit about your social work skills, during this pandemic, I know you and I have talked a little bit over the last couple of years about kind of what it's like to use social work skills as a legislator. And folks, just remembering that being a policymaker is social work practice, and by law in Minnesota is social work practice. People have to be licensed if they're legislators who are who are social workers. But how have you seen yourself using your social work skills during this pandemic in particular?
Every day. I mean, one example, my husband is always like, man, you pick fights with people. And I'm like, no, I don't. I just, you know, when you see something, I think you see something, you say something. That should be like a mantra for social work. And I mean, I feel like it is, but see something, say something. So it's a call to ethics every single day. My mom is a disabled adult who struggles with, you know, mental illness. She's done her whole life, also addiction. And one example of, so she called me, she went through a, she doesn't drive. She walked up to a fast food restaurant and said, there's no way for me to order because of COVID. There's no way for me to order a house. She walked up to the window, the drive-through window. And they said, no, you can't order food here. So she calls me. So she walked away. She started walking away. A guy in a car stopped her and said, I'll go order for you. So he went and he went around again, ordered her food, gave it to her. She called me and told me about it. And so I said, oh, that's not right. Right. Where is the justice in that? So we are essentially, if you drive, we will serve you during a pandemic.
Yeah.
And in this neighborhood in South Minneapolis, where there are a lot of people that live there because of the Green Line. And so you start thinking about this and you're like, why? Not right. So then, of course, I took that and I went straight to the company. I went straight to hospitality, the hospitality lobbyist at the Capitol. And I said, what is your reason for this? You need to change this now. This is discrimination. And they did. But how many other people had did that happen to before that I spoke up? So and I would just say that we all have this, so the larger society, will think somebody else is going to take care of it. Somebody else will do that. I don't need to do it. Absolutely. I would say the best thing I've learned over my life and by, you know, one of the things that really empowers social workers is being able to stop. I was at Avivo and when there was the tent community that was building right outside of the freeway, one of the workers said how she's a social worker, how she just one day stopped and said, how can I help you? And that is social. Social work is passion. It is not a fight. It's passion and it's advocacy. And I think that how you say it is really important. So yeah, that's, I guess, an example.
Yeah, absolutely. And I love that notion of if you see something, say something. I mean, I think that, so I'm a Karen. Any of you who've seen any of the Karen memes know that there's this sort of internal joke going on that Karens will always say something, right? My kid reminds me that all the time. But I think that's the social worker in all of us too, that you have to call out injustice when you see it. And I think this notion of expecting that our policymakers or someone will do something about it. I think, and I say this a lot in supervision trainings as well, like as a supervisor, you don't always know what your staff members are doing all the time. You can't watch every inside thing. So it's that same notion that like you need people to let you know if they have grievances, if things aren't going well, if, you know, if there are even slight injustices that somebody should do something about that. They should make sure that people can walk up to whatever food window and be able to get served without having a car. You know, it takes a phone call or two, especially if your daughter's a House of Representatives member. I bet that helps. But, you know, I think for each of us, we're all doing these little things every day, and we forget that as social workers, that's just in our DNA now. We all do that advocacy work for ourselves, for our family members, for our colleagues and our clients every day. And so just continuing that work is that everyday advocacy we're talking about today too. Heather, can you tell us a little bit about how you would recommend people lobby legislators in this current frame of the world? What actually works? What should we skip? How should people spend their energy in terms of lobbying efforts when it comes to the things that they care about?
Well, first of all, I mean, if this is right now, it's got to be the most challenging time to lobby a legislator in general, if I'm honest with you. Okay. If it's to do with a very pressing need, you know, yes, go ahead and do it. But boy, I tell you, we are the only money we're going to be spending this year is on necessities because we are just about to run a deficit. So it is a trying time. But I think that probably, you know, if you're working in the social work field, you're going to be advocating for things that are really important. So I would just say, like, number one is remember the power within you, that stories are just so valuable, that being able to say, this is what I experience, this is what I see from patient to patient to patient. So, you know, talk about the stories, talk about the scenarios, and then think of, you know, whenever somebody emails me, I always email back, I'll say, what's your solution? So if they tell me a problem, but they don't give me a solution, I do it with my kids too. I'm the worst. I'm like, give me a solution. Don't just tell me problems. Think about solutions, because the reality is lawmakers are just people, right? We're people that felt passionate, that really decided we were going to knock on doors and thought we were going to, you know, do something great. And then you get here by the way now and you're like, oh my gosh, how are we ever going to fix the problem that we're in? Mm-hmm. I have no idea. And it's very challenging to be in that position. But I would say, yes, know your power, talk about stories, and you have that representative, whoever that is, that in your community, you have every right to email them, and they work for you. So just remember that. And that's probably my best advice to you. Remember your power, though.
Absolutely. I love that. And your power, you guys, your power is your vote. That is your money in this whole thing. They are currency for these folks, and their job is to listen to all of us. So Heather, I know you love listening to all of us all of the time, but for each of us to talk to our own legislators in particular, I think that's really important advice for us. So Heather, before we go into some Q&A, we have a few questions from our audience that are coming in. So before we jump into that, do you have any last thoughts, comments you want to share with us? And just for our audience, just remembering that it wasn't Heather's job this morning to talk about all the issues. She could talk policy all day long to all of us. We're going to leave that to our policy partners to talk about some of the issues. We really wanted to get some perspective from where things are at from Heather this morning. So thoughts, Heather, before we move to the Q&A?
No, but I'm very happy you have Sue Abderholden from NAMI on the call, because Sue and I work together often. And she's such a huge asset. So we just worked on, and I'll let her talk about that later. But yeah, it's the issues are really there are so many. And, you know, I think the most important thing that I would tell you about it is because of this virus does not mean we should not do policy work this year. It is a policy year. Minnesotans are counting on us. I need social workers to lobby us and tell your legislators that it's still important that things get done. Now, what that is and what is possible, that's challenging. I can't tell you, but you should still absolutely push on important issues, and I hope you do. So I'll look forward to taking some of the questions.
That sounds great. All right, let's move things to Lauren. Lauren, can you get your mic rolling so we can hear you and you can share some?
Hi, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
We have so many great questions, so I'm just gonna jump right in. One that I really love from Jessica Toft. Hi, Jessica. She asked, what do you think about a bill that would recognize first responders, that would help with student loans, assistance with retirement, and excellent healthcare benefits, since they're threatening their lives for the benefit and safety of the country?
I think that sounds great. I mean, we just passed a first responders workers' compensation bill. So if somebody, a first responder, contracts COVID-19, that we would allow them to tap into workers' compensation immediately. I agree. I think there's so many things we could do, and that's definitely a possibility. So send me an email. It ends up being, I would remind everybody of this. It ends up being, how much money do we have? And will we have to do cuts because of this next year? And I promise you, we're gonna have to do cuts. So we just have to be very careful about spending right now. But I think it's a great idea, and we can absolutely explore it and try to figure out creative ways to fund that. That's a good idea.
And I know on the national level, there's been some movement on some support and safety in particular for first responders. I think there's always this trick, and often, folks, just to remind you, we are the Minnesota chapter of NASW. NASW is the National Association of Social Workers. And on the national level, they're doing all kinds of things, including this sort of work that Jessica's talking about right now. So we focus as much as we can on the things that are state level. And so, Heather, I think that's an important caveat for you and legislators to remind folks, is like, okay, this is something that's in our purview, or this is something that we need to ramp up to a different level also. So Lauren, do you have another question for us?
Yeah, so now kind of moving to support for not just first responders, but the community in general. This is from Katie. She asks, is there bipartisan support for rent and mortgage relief during the pandemic?
We hope so. So right now we are working on that. Our approximate ask is $100 million for the state of Minnesota. But I mean, if I'm honest with you, that's been a big frustration of mine, is that we haven't, that should be in this bill today that we're going to pass. As somebody that grew up, you know, renting, I think it's so critical that we address this. I can't say that there's bipartisan support 100% yet, but I think that there's interest in doing something around rent and mortgage relief. Exactly what that's going to look like, I'm not sure. We have heard from a lot of constituents as well throughout the state of Minnesota on property taxes as well. And so we're working with counties trying to figure out what that looks like as well, because that's another big thing that people are thinking about. So yes, rent and mortgage assistance, I think we need to do as soon as possible. Whoever asked the question, I thank you. And I think that when you're doing your advocacy today, please focus on that, because so many people need help with their rent. And I don't know if everybody heard, but those federal checks that, the $1,200 checks and $500 if you have kids. So if you put a bank account on your taxes and you tie it to just your tax refund to go into your bank account, you're gonna get your check first. So that's great. That's awesome. Except for people that are low income, that don't have a bank account, because who knows why? And then that could take them months. And those are the people that need it the most. So that is so frustrating. When I found that out, I thought my head was going to combust, because I'm like, the people that don't have a bank account, that maybe use, just a cash checking place, they're the ones that need it the most, but we are not focusing on that. And that is why it's so critically important who sits at the table. And I apologize, that really bugs me so bad.
I love it. Thank you for that passionate response to that one, Heather. I appreciate that. It sounds like the ask that you're talking about that people could bring to their legislators today and in the coming days is there's been a discussion of $100 million for rent and mortgage relief in Minnesota. Is that the number that we're talking about?
$100 million is what we're going to be proposing. Okay. So yes, please focus on the rent. What we know is, you know, everybody deserves a home. Everybody. Okay. And making sure that people, yes, the evictions, that was a good step, but it's not far enough. And I think everybody will acknowledge that if you care about housing security. And good step, not far enough. We need to do some renter's assistance and mortgage assistance. Absolutely. Because you look at the whole path.
Awesome. Great. Okay. Lauren, how about other questions from our audience?
Yeah, well, I just want to add, we've gotten a couple comments asking, Heather, for you to advocate that social workers be included in the group of first responders who would be getting relief from the legislature.
Mm-hmm. So actually, so Sue can talk about this as well, but Sue Abderholden and I from NAMI have worked on some things to make sure that, say, anybody that's working directly going into somebody's home or residential treatment, social workers that are having direct contact, we are. That absolutely is something we're advocating. But if you're doing over services over Zoom, we have to be very strategic. There's not endless dollars. But if you have direct care, patient care contact, you're absolutely right. We are already, and we're also looking for hazard pay as well. So for those same social workers doing that work, because they are putting themselves at risk, and we do appreciate you. And I just want you to know that we see you. If you have ideas or thoughts, or if you want to tell me your story, I would encourage you to email me at rep.heather.edelson@house.mn, because I do want to hear your stories.
Awesome. Lauren, do we have another question from the audience?
We'll take one more. This is a question from Caitlin. She said, I currently work with a lot of undocumented residents. Are there going to be any policies that represent and support that population?
Oh, it's such a good question. I don't know. We're working on it. And I will tell you that that's another big flaw. So, Minneapolis has passed some support, but that's not good enough. I mean, the reality is our economy has been strong, and because of undocumented immigrants, and they pay taxes, and this idea that they don't belong here is preposterous. Like, it's so frustrating. So I don't know where that's also another one along with rents that we're trying to figure out what to do. And it shouldn't take us this long, you guys. I'll tell you, as somebody that's my first term, it shouldn't take us this long. People can't wait. And I don't think, like, as somebody that has lived where my mom had boyfriends so that we could pay our rent, lived in situations where I was homeless at 16, people can't wait. But here we are, and we're fighting, we're passing a bill that doesn't address some of the needs that we need it to address. Mm-hmm. And my frustration is that sometimes we do this because it looks like we're doing something, but it's not enough, and we still need to do more. And I think I will tell you that the Speaker of the House knows that. The Majority Leader knows that. I think Paul Gazelka even knows that. So I would just say that we need to get to work on these really complicated issues. And you know what? The $1,200 check, undocumented workers aren't getting that. So what do we do? Like, how do we, like, government is very frustrating once you work in it. I'll just tell you that. But we do know about it. We are going to work on it. I don't have the best answer, but we know.
Well, from an outsider's perspective, it's absolutely frustrating to try to keep up with it. I really appreciate your candid response to that. And I'm sure it's hard to navigate, and we appreciate all that you have done and will continue to do. And I love that we have the voice of social workers in our legislature, and we definitely need more of that. We're gonna talk about that later this morning too. All right, Lauren and all of our attendees, thank you so much for the great questions. We will, after our policy updates, after each policy update, we will have a little bit of time for Q&A for each presenter. And then at the end, we will open it back up for any larger questions for a few minutes as well. In addition, we will be continuing to answer your questions in the chat and after the event as well. So let's go ahead and
add. We have almost 750 people with us today, which is so exciting. Yeah. We have a lot of questions coming in, so we won't be able to get to all of them, but we are doing our best. So thank you, and please keep sending your questions in.
Absolutely. Yeah, we absolutely won't be able to get to everyone, but we really appreciate you chiming in, and Lauren will do her best to sort through those and keep tee up some questions that are helpful. Heather Edelson, thank you so much for being with us this morning. We really appreciate your insights and your willingness to spend some time with us on a very busy day, as they all are. So thanks again for being with us this morning.
Absolutely. And people can always email me if they have other questions too. Thank you so much. Bye.
All right. Bye. Thanks, Heather. All right, folks. Now it's time to hear from our first policy partner. Our first presenter this morning is from the Minnesota Council of Nonprofits. We have Marie Ellis with us, who is Public Policy Director there. She, in this role, advances the mission and work of Minnesota's nonprofit sector through direct lobbying and supports MCN's members as they discover and harness their own advocacy power. Now, NASW is a member of MCN on behalf of many of our social workers who work in the nonprofit sector. In addition, many of you social workers out there are members of MCN because you work in the nonprofit sector as well, and many of your organizations are probably members. But I think MCN is a really important pulse point for all of us for care of social workers and the clients that we serve in our nonprofit sector. So I want to first go ahead and welcome Marie. Marie, can you, can we see Marie? Can we hear Marie?
I think we can. Can you hear me?
All right, I can hear you.
I think I'm good then. I popped up on my own screen, so hopefully that
works. Okay, fantastic.
Thank you, Karen, and thanks for inviting me to be a part of this. Next year, I'll help you. I'll work to find some more speakers who are not all white women. We can figure that out together. I know that.
It's an ongoing struggle that we are very much paying attention to. Absolutely.
Yes. So help me.
This morning we have 10 minutes or so for you to present some things, and I'm just gonna tee up kind of some of the things that we'd ask you to speak on behalf of, so everyone sort of knows what you're going to be covering. And then we'll have about 5 minutes for Q&A from the audience. So we're asking you to talk a little bit about what you're working on and focusing on right now. Also, what has been achieved this session, and what are your plans for next year's session? I know for many of our policy partners and for us at NASW, and as Heather said, you know, there are certain things that we need to just keep moving on. They are very time sensitive. We need to do them right now. And there's other things that many of us are putting on the back burner and saying, okay, we're going to hold that and bring it back for next session. So talk a little bit about those things. And then what are some things that folks can, what actions can people take today and in the coming days? What can we advocate for and in the coming months that will help us, especially in the nonprofit sector? So Marie, go right ahead.
Thank you, I appreciate it. So again, I'm Marie Ellis. I'm the Public Policy Director at the Minnesota Council of Nonprofits. We are a membership organization, so we have about 2,200 members across the state. Many of you probably are members through your organization. I've been lobbying for about 15 years. I started in DC, was there briefly because federal politics, it's not my jam, and came back to Minnesota, and I love my work. I love being an advocate. My title is Public Policy Director, and a lot of folks who do work similar to what I do call them, you know, say I work in government relations or I work in public policy. And I'm always very careful to say that I am a lobbyist. I think Representative Edelson said it well. She said, how we say it is really important. And I'm trying to end the stigma around lobbying that we're not all like these big fat white dudes with bags of money that that convince people to do things. And usually people get that when I then say I'm a lobbyist for nonprofits. They figure out that maybe not all lobbyists are evil. So that's pretty helpful. I'm not a social worker. I'm an attorney. I've been asked a number of times whether it's better to go to law school or to become a social worker when you want to go into advocacy. And I actually think that you all probably have the right idea. People seem to think that lawyers know all the things about all the laws, but that is not what we learn in law school. And I think social work can, in a lot of ways, be a better background for advocacy work. So good decisions. My work is primarily fits into two buckets. One, like Karen said, is helping nonprofits figure out their own advocacy work. And so we do a lot of trainings in the summer and fall, looking at what nonprofits can do in terms of advocacy work. I hear all the time, oh, I work at a 501c3, so I can't do any advocacy. And that is not true. You can definitely do advocacy. You have to be careful when you're doing direct lobbying, but advocacy is wide open. If you want to educate lawmakers about what your clients are dealing with, there's no limit on how much you can do that. So please continue to do that. So a lot of trainings on that, on how to lobby, things like that. And then the other piece of my work is doing direct lobbying on behalf of the nonprofit sector. So it's pretty interesting. I'm kind of two steps removed from direct service in a way. Like I lobby on behalf of the organizations who do the direct service as a whole. So I'll just give you an example of that. One of the things that I'm working on right now, as I'm sure you're gonna be shocked to hear this, but it's related to coronavirus. And this might get a little boring, so just hang with me. I'm gonna try to make it really easy. Nonprofit employers can choose to either use the state's unemployment insurance system that all other businesses use, or they can be reimbursing employers, which means they essentially self-insure. And so those nonprofits, including MCN, we have a separate trust where we keep money. And when somebody on our team uses unemployment benefits, the state bills that trust for money. Okay. The governor, through an executive order, provided relief for all of the other organizations, the taxpaying organizations, and that's great. And that's a lot of nonprofits, and so we're extremely glad that he did that. But the organizations that are reimbursing employers are only getting about 50% relief. So those organizations will have to pay out of pocket and will likely run through their trust very quickly because no one has been expecting this level of layoffs at a lot of organizations. And so one of the things we're working on is advocating at both the federal level and the state level for some relief for those nonprofits. And so you can see I'm not really working directly on things that affect clients of nonprofits, particularly in human services, which I assume is where most of you are working, but rather on the things that impact the organization itself. And so really trying to help the organizations work well and save money through taxes they shouldn't have to pay, things like that. Another win on something we've been working on right now is that oftentimes when Congress provides relief for businesses, they provide it through a business income tax. And the problem is that does not help nonprofit businesses because we don't pay income tax. So instead, what we've been asking for, and I don't get to take credit for this because I've only been in this role for less than a year, but advocates who have been doing this a lot longer have been working with Congress to try to get them to understand that those income tax relief doesn't help nonprofit businesses. So the CARES Act, the big third stimulus package, has in it relief through payroll taxes, and nonprofits do pay payroll taxes. So that's like a really big win for us right now. Hang on, I'm looking, I taped my notes up on my wall so that I could like, it would look like I'm just, you know, thinking and looking off to remember what I was gonna talk about instead of reading my notes. But now I've just told you all that I taped my notes to the wall, so that was useless. What was I gonna say next? Oh, I just wanted to mention, I am terrible at direct service. It makes me anxious and uncomfortable, and I'm real bad at it. So a lot of people tell me that is how doing lobbying work makes them feel, that talking with legislators is just really nerve-wracking. So I just wanted to put out there that, like, I feel ya. And we can get through this together because I know it can feel nerve-wracking, but it doesn't need to be. Let's see, what else am I working on right now? Was there anything else I wanted to mention? The next thing I need to be doing later this week actually is looking back at the policy priorities we set in the fall as an organization. Honestly, I'm having trouble remembering what some of them are. And so looking back to figure out what was it we said we were going to try to get done this session and what is still relevant and what now is completely irrelevant and there's no chance it will happen and we should just wait. Let's see, one of Karen's other questions was what's been achieved this session. So I would say one of the things I'm most proud of this session is there's been a small group of organizations who have been taking a look at racial equity through the bonding process. I'm not going to go into a huge background about what bonding is. A lot of you probably have a sense of that if you've done these Days on the Hill before. essentially it's funding from the state for large infrastructure projects. And I know the Lieutenant Governor is going to be speaking with you all later. She said something a few weeks ago that I really liked. She said, bonding is like a secret handshake. And it's totally true. And it's a secret handshake that statewide is worth like $1 billion, give or take a few hundred million. And so what we've found is that the people who understand bonding are the people who have had connections in government over the years. And since government is still vast majority is still white, we're finding that the people who understand the bonding process tend to be the white-led organizations. And organizations led by people of color just don't have that information. And so making sure that we're teaching people the secret handshake has been important this year, and then hopefully moving to like dismantling that secret handshake at some point, so everybody understands bonding and it doesn't have to be the secret way of getting some funding for infrastructure projects. That obviously has been put on hold as we've just been trying to figure out how nonprofits stay afloat while they're seeing increased demand and decreased resources. But it's something that I don't think a lot of folks have worked on before. It's kind of started a year or so ago with some other people, and then this group I'm working with kind of hopped on top of their work, and we're all working together now, and it's really exciting. And then as for what we can advocate on today, I'm not going to talk about specifics. I think Susie and Sue probably will, because the things I'm working on, just it wouldn't make sense to ask you all as individuals to advocate on them. But I do want to note, I hope you won't be afraid to talk about racial equity when you talk with your legislators, because you are seeing things that they don't see. And that brings me to another point, which is that you are the expert. So if you work with people who are trying to find housing, you don't have to know every housing law that's ever been written or what bills are related to housing at the legislature right now in order to talk to lawmakers, because what they need to hear from you is what you're seeing happening. They're not at homeless shelters right now. Like, some of them probably do great volunteer work and that's wonderful, but they're not doing what you do, which is spending time with people every day and seeing trends, seeing what people need that other people just won't notice. And the legislature is still primarily white. It's changed quite a bit in the last few years, but it's nowhere near looking like what the population of Minnesota looks like. And that's true for the lobbyist world as well. We're still vast majority white. And so I think these issues of racial equity are not at the top of people's mind as much as they should be. And so as you speak, you know, speaking about centering racial equity, I think is really important. And so I would just leave you with that thought. And I actually don't know how long I've been talking. So Karen, hopefully that was about how long I was supposed to talk, and happy to take questions.
That's awesome. Thanks so much, Marie. Now, you did great. We do have a couple of questions from our audience, and we'll turn to those in just a moment. I just wanted to thank you for bringing up the issues of racial equity. That is absolutely at the very top of our legislative agenda at NASW Minnesota. And across the board, in terms of every area of practice that we do work on, issues of racial equity are sort of at the baseline of every one of those. So that's a really important component. I think you've touched on some really important things for the nonprofit sector that, you know, some of these things, folks, are not the things that we as social workers, even in our practice, are thinking about every day. We're thinking about practice and how it's affecting our clients and that sort of thing. And we want to make sure we have jobs. And it's people like Marie and the Council of Nonprofits and others that are working to make sure that that infrastructure stays strong and supported, and that our government is not only thinking about government services at this time, but is also thinking about businesses and nonprofits and sort of all of these things. And so we don't all get forgotten in all of that. So I really appreciate the work that you're doing, Marie. I think that when people step back and think about, you know, their ability to have jobs, to continue the work that they do, so much of that comes back to the work that MCN is doing also. So thank you for that.
Let me put in a plug quickly. We've been doing a call with the Office of the Governor and Lieutenant Governor every Monday. We've got the last one, I think, is coming up this coming Monday, and we're hoping to focus it on issues of racial equity during the pandemic and what the state can be doing. And so if you're interested in that, you can just go to our website under events, and it's this coming Monday. So I think that's the 20th. You can find it.
Awesome. Yeah, I've seen those. That sounds fantastic. Thanks so much for reminding people those are out there. All right, Lauren, do we have a question or two from the audience we could take?
We
Thank you. I'm going to start with Katie. Since we're talking about racial disparity, she asks, I know in a lot of places there's a huge racial disparity in coronavirus death rates. Are we seeing that in Minnesota, and how are we working towards changing it?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I'm not an expert on what's happening in Minnesota, but I was talking with the Lieutenant Governor yesterday about this on our weekly call. Yeah, yesterday was Monday. I know, time doesn't really seem to matter much anymore. And so I actually think that would be a great question to ask her, because she has been following this. She'll mention a website that maybe you can find in the meantime and put in the chat. It's like a state dashboard on COVID-19, how many cases we've had, how many deaths. I think what she said essentially,
the Minnesota Department of Health,
yet, but we don't have enough numbers to really know. And then it's presumed that we would see that here as well.
Thank you. Another question from Courtney. She asks, as a person who works at a nonprofit, I'm wondering, what can we do to ensure that our services stay afloat?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Hopefully the folks in leadership at all of the nonprofits are looking into the federal stimulus things that are available right now. So in the CARES Act, there is something called the PPP, the Paycheck Protection Program, I think. Mm-hmm. If you just Google PPP right now, it'll come up. It's a forgivable loan through the Small Business Administration. It's up to $10 million, but it's based on how much you pay, how many staff you have, and how much you pay them. So I don't foresee many nonprofits getting that full $10 million. The rollout has been tricky. It happened so fast that banks weren't really ready to help with the lending, and there were a lot of questions on the forms. For example, you have to check a box that says we are not in the business of lobbying. So I got calls from a lot of different nonprofits saying, you know, we do some lobbying, but are we in the business of it? No. Unless you're working for a lobbying firm, that doesn't count. But point being, so there's some really good money there because that's forgivable. There are also, like I mentioned, some payroll tax relief and something called the EIDL loan. It's EIDL, I can't remember what it stands for right now, but that's another one that if you Google, it will, tons of information will pop up. Other than that, I think we're all trying to figure out ways to do things differently, right? I mean, this, what we're doing right now is a good example of that. So I've talked with a lot of nonprofits who are doing more of their services online, which is really tricky, I understand. I mean, depending on the population you work with, it might be just impossible. I think if there's a way that your organizations can figure out what it is you need, and there's a gap there in what the federal government is providing for organizations, definitely reach out, because that's something that I need to know about. I talk with elected officials all the time, and one of the things that lobbyists do, particularly association lobbyists like myself, is we gather the input from the whole sector and then, you know, kind of put it, tie it up with a nice little bow and present it to lawmakers. And they appreciate that because then they're not getting 8,000 emails, a lot of which are duplicated or a little confusing. And, you know, they get one letter that says, like, here are the big things we're dealing with, and here's how you can follow up for more information. So again, if there are specific things where you're like, we need relief for this and it's not available, but maybe it could be, let me know. I'd be interested in hearing about that.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Marie. I just wanted to follow up on that comment you made about the CARES money that's out there from the federal government to support nonprofits. I'm on a board of a nonprofit in North Minneapolis and just heard that they had applied for that CARES money last week and the money's already in their bank account.
So oh, good.
It's working and people are receiving it, and they happen to have a really good relationship with their lender and were able to work it out pretty simply. So I appreciate that that's happening and that nonprofits are able to pay their staff in the interim. And as long as they keep them on payroll, those are then forgivable, which is really awesome for nonprofits. So.
And
right.
Often it's a little scary to try to get into the mind of Congress, but on this one, I think we're able to see that what Congress was trying to do is keep employees attached to employers. And mm-hmm. So even if there's nothing for the employee to do, Congress is saying, we will give you money to keep them employed, like just keep together, stay together, guys, or stay together, y'all. And that way you're keeping that relationship, and also otherwise they'd be paying that through unemployment insurance. So it's a really a way to keep people employed.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you for being such a great advocate for our sector. We really appreciate it. Thanks for being with us this morning, and we look forward to maybe seeing you next year on the stage at Day at the Capitol. So we appreciate everything you're doing, and I hope you have a great week. I know you have to leave us this morning to go do some real work too. All right. So thanks so much, Marie.
Well, thank you all, and thanks for the good work you're all doing.
Absolutely. And we'll say goodbye to Lauren for the moment, and Lauren will be back to do Q&A with our next speaker. So next up, hold on, suddenly my computer, there we go. All right, so next up we have Sue Abderholden, who is Executive Director of NAMI Minnesota. And while Sue goes ahead and unmutes herself and gets her camera going, I'm just gonna do a quick intro for her. Sue is really a tireless advocate for those living with mental illness and working alongside their families and communities. As Heather Edelson also alluded to, she knows our legislators well, has been around for a long time. She brings over 30 years of experience in the nonprofit and advocacy sector and has been with NAMI Minnesota as their executive director since October of 2001. So at this point, we're going to give Sue her 10 minutes to talk about what she's working on right now, what's been achieved, what she's going to work toward next session, and what we should all be advocating on today and in the coming months. So Sue, are you with us?
I am with you.
All right, fantastic. I will turn my camera off and give you your 10 minutes, and we'll go until about not quite 10 after, and then we'll do some Q&A afterward.
Great, well, thank you so much for inviting me today. I've been able to come a couple of years in a row and really appreciate all the work that you all do, and really want to underscore how important it is for you to talk to your legislators. I always start out by saying that if we look at our mental health system, it's not broken. If you look at the history of funding, Medicaid, Medicare, private insurance, grants, the reality is we never built it. And so what we've really been trying to do is identify what works and build it and fund it. This year, of course, has been a very strange year. We started in with a lot of different policy recommendations to really kind of plug some of those holes in our mental health system. And of course, most of those are now, frankly, dead. I'm going to point out a couple of things that are still alive, some things that we're trying to do in light of COVID, and then just go into questions. So for the past couple of years, we had a very large group of stakeholders looking at the Commitment Act. The Commitment Act has not been updated since before I came to NAMI. And of course, a lot of things have changed over these, you know, nearly 20 years. The bill actually, which is authored by Representative Edelson and Senator Ralph, does a couple of different things. One, we get rid of outdated language. We don't have regional treatment centers anymore. We have state operated services. So we made some changes like that. We use people first language instead of saying the mentally ill throughout the statute. We also wanted to recognize we have a lot more community services than we did back then. So we changed the definitions and where people could be committed to include the full array of community-based services, including intensive residential treatment, assertive community treatment teams, you know, ACTs, all those kinds of services. We rewrote the section on transport holds and emergency holds to make it actually easier to understand and less confusing, and also to make sure that police officers know that if a mental health professional says someone should be transported, that they meet the definition and the criteria, that they can do that and not get into an argument, especially with a crisis team. We expanded the definition of health officer, so those are people who can make the decisions about a transport hold, to include all mental health professionals and all members of a mental health crisis team. So mental health practitioners who are under the supervision of a mental health professional on a crisis team can actually make that, decision. We also made sure that an examiner, who is the person who decides that someone can be placed on a 72-hour hold, also is every mental health professional. It wasn't. And we thought, you know, it's not just the psychologists, but clinical social workers, LMFT, LPCC should be able to make those decisions in those emergency rooms. We still kept the court examiner to be a psychologist and a physician and an APRN, but at least this will help, especially in some of the emergency rooms, I'm going to be honest, I think you know a lot more than a physician's assistant about whether someone needs to be placed on a 72-hour hold. We also made sure that a commitment doesn't automatically end if the paperwork isn't filed. So right now, if someone, a case manager in a county, doesn't file the 30, 60, 90-day paperwork, the commitment goes away. And that can be really dangerous for some people who really need to stay committed because they are a danger to themselves or others. So this way, the court would actually send out a notice. We have a new thing in here called engagement, voluntary engagement. What's so hard for families is when they see their loved one decompensating, or perhaps the symptoms are coming in for the first time, and the person won't do treatment voluntarily, there is literally nothing they can do till they become a danger to themselves or others. And we don't want to see someone, frankly, get that sick. So instead, what we're doing, and it would be voluntary to counties, but we know counties, many counties said they would step up to do this, is that a family or someone else could actually contact the county and say, I'm worried about this person. They would send out an outreach engagement team. It could be peer specialists, could be homeless outreach workers, could be a crisis team member when they are not on a call, to really develop a relationship with that person and to engage them in treatment voluntarily. We think this would really help. We don't really want to see people committed. We want them to be well. And so this would be a strategy to do that. We also made sure that you could do a joint commitment between the state and community services. We think this will be helpful. You know, the state doesn't really provide the majority of services anymore, and so they shouldn't be placed into that. We also are allowing Jarvis procedures, so involuntary medications, to be administered in a jail. Right now, they aren't, although once in a while you have a jail that will. And as long as they have the proper healthcare personnel, they'd be able to do that. So perhaps we wouldn't have people totally decompensating in jail. And then we also made sure that healthcare and psychiatric directives are a huge part of the Commitment Act. This bill is actually on the floor of the House, so it made it through three different committees in the House. On the Senate side, it was actually made it through Judiciary and was sitting in Health and Human Services. Senator Abler has put it into his major policy bill, so we have a really good chance of getting this passed. We operated by consensus, so if anyone on this group did not like, excuse me, a language change, we didn't do it. so it has a good, you know, there's a lot of consensus behind this bill. A couple of other things that Senator Abler has put in his bill is allowing crisis teams for children to be in the emergency rooms, to expand Youth Act assertive community treatment up to age 25. Right now it's age 21. And we had some great testimony about a young person who at 21 would not have qualified for the adult criteria for ACT, but still needed those intensive services to get through. Making sure that respite care does not require having a case manager. There's some language around PRTF, psychiatric residential treatment facilities, which are also really important. Let's see. Oh, and if the state requires some new reporting requirement for community mental health providers, they couldn't do that without a pay increase. So recognizing that every time they add new reporting, it actually costs money for the providers, and making sure that they recognize that. Working with the House members, particularly with Representative Edelson and three others, we also identified some areas that we thought needed to be addressed during COVID-19. One is, as she mentioned earlier, hazard pay. So if you're doing frontline mental health treatment or support, so if you're in residential, day treatment, crisis homes, or doing in-home therapy in person, you should get hazard pay because you certainly are putting yourself more at risk. The other thing was to have some grants to really cover some of those additional costs, whether it's for the provider in terms of being able to deliver services through video or phone services, but also personal protection equipment, which many providers do not have. And the other thing that we really have realized, and it really is an equity issue as well, is we have a lot of people with mental illnesses and families who do not have not only a laptop or an iPad, but also don't even have a regular phone. And so there's no way that they are staying connected. And that is something that NAMI has really been concerned about. So people who are used to having someone come in their home to make sure that they have food and you know, that their apartment is not, you know, in a horrible shape, they're alone. They're isolated. There's nothing that's happening with them. And we're really afraid that we're going to see greater crises in the near future. Another issue is making sure that we do retroactive payment for telemedicine. Right now, it's only back to April 1st. Many providers went beyond that. And we're also concerned through the Department of Education, you know, kids who were in level four settings, so basically, especially in EVD programs, or if they were medically fragile, a lot of them had one-to-one paraprofessionals. Now those children are home 24/7 with families who are not getting in-home services, who do not have paraprofessionals there, and frankly, who are reaching a crisis point. And so we have been working with the Department of Ed to consider actually allowing paraprofessionals voluntarily to go into a family's home to help them during this time. So we're waiting to hear from them about that. Some other things we're doing in terms of the executive orders that I just want to cover briefly is on the community side. So I know Susie's going to talk more about telemedicine from the healthcare perspective, but from mental health and the community side, we wanted to make sure that phone services, you know, calling someone by phone, got reimbursed through those community services, such as adult rehab mental health services, children's therapeutic services and supports, targeted case management, and even some of the substance use disorder treatment services. So that isn't an executive order. They are waiting for the federal government to approve that. The one thing that was not included, and we don't understand why, and we've asked, is assertive community treatment, because that level of service also needs to be reimbursed for phone as well. A really important part for us was continuing health insurance coverage. We didn't want someone who frankly needed help filling out all those forms to keep their medical assistance, lose it because they're not getting any in-home services. So that was extended so people don't have to worry if they needed to reapply during this time. Also making sure that school-linked mental health services, they can use that grant money for use of telephone connection or video connection with children and their families as well. So we thought that was really important. And the other thing they did was increase the limit on medications from 34 days to 90 days. Again, really important so that people are not having to leave their home, obtain that medication, you know, and put themselves at risk. I think one thing that people really have not recognized or talked about much is that people with serious mental illnesses are actually at greater risk of catching the virus. And the reason for that is they have a lot of co-occurring medical issues and they have a higher smoking rate. So they have lung disease, they have heart disease, they perhaps are obese because of the medications, they have diabetes, and all of that places them at risk. And so we really want to make sure that we are keeping people safe, and that they are getting the in-home services and supports that they so desperately need. So those are some of the major things. I mean, we really hope we can come back in next year and really work on all those things that should be happening in our mental health system. We had recognized that, for example, if somebody is in the hospital on day 30, they lose their CADI waiver and they have to start all over again. And we had a bill to make sure that they could at least pick up where they left off. And perhaps do a reassessment while they were getting services, but we didn't want people discharged into nothing. There was things around schooling to mental health to make sure we kept those grants sustainable, and making sure that we kept those relationships between those providers and the schools and not made them a true competitive grant. Lots of other issues out there. There is so much that we need to do, but I guess I will stop there and see if there are any questions.
Thanks so much, Sue. I think you bring up some just really important small details and big things that are affecting folks that are living with mental illness in our communities. I think the personal protection for social workers is really important and for all providers that are working with folks, but some of the things you talk about in terms of tech needs, about in-home care, about folks who are used to having a certain level of providers in their lives, and everything is different. Like, we all know that that affects every individual very differently. And so I really appreciate you being so on the pulse of the details. And I'm always amazed how you know all of the details of what's needed for people in all different areas of service. And so I really appreciate that from NAMI. I just want to remind all of our attendees that NASW is a member of the Mental Health Legislative Network, and that is how we stay really well connected to you and to what NAMI is doing and the Mental Health Legislative Network as a whole. So at this time, I'd like to invite Lauren back to ask a couple of questions. I think she's got one or two from our audience.
Yeah, great question for Sue from Emma. She asks, what are ways that we can create greater access to mental health services and trauma care for clients, specifically immigrant or refugee / asylee clients who come from cultures that have stigmas against mental health?
I think the biggest thing is to get rid of the requirement to do a full-blown diagnostic assessment, you know, right off the bat. I mean, we can't allow three visits now, but I think we have to really think, we have to view it differently and we have to approach it differently, and we can't just do it from, and I don't like to say medical model, to be honest, because we do think these are medical conditions and we should be, you know, treated as other healthcare conditions. But even then we approach it differently. And so we need that flexibility within our payment structures to allow that to happen.
We'll do one more. This is from Christina. She asks, are there any proposed bills at the Capitol regarding psychiatric care for jail and prison inmates living with serious mental illness?
Yes. that is really a tough one because jails are under a different authority than prisons. And so it makes it a little bit harder. There's a couple of things going on. One is last year we passed a bill to create a competency restoration task force, and that task force is meeting now. And we are looking at, number one, why do we have more people who are deemed incompetent to stand trial, but also what happens to them when they're in jail? And what can we do to make sure that they are getting, frankly, the treatment that they deserve? We had a bill that would actually create greater incentives for counties to contract with their local community mental health center than one of the large companies like MEND. Because what we know is when someone is discharged from the jail, if they already are connected to, say, a community mental health provider, they don't have to look for a new prescriber for medications or a therapist. They already have one, which we think is better. But I think the bigger issue is, why are people ending up there in the first place? And we think, and we had a bill that would have required all 911 operators to actually do warm handoffs to the mental health crisis teams instead of sending out police for every single thing. We also had a bill for more police training so that they're recognizing, you know, the symptoms of a mental illness and what to do. We do not want to go, I know that there's the big, you know, show on PBS this week. We do not want to go the route of central receiving centers or assessment centers that have been developed in other states. Mainly, I want to point out southern states, which have, you know, virtually zero funding for community mental health. So why are we looking at southern states for ideas on how to build our mental health system when they don't even have Medicaid expansion? But what we want to do is build our mental health system and not the criminal justice system. We want to make it easier for the individual to access mental health treatment, not for police to drop people off. And so as we're, you know, developing our mental health system, let's put the money there so that people never end up in the jail to begin with.
This is so helpful, Sue. And as all of you can hear and see, I'm sure Sue is really on the pulse of so many of these issues. I really appreciate you being with us, Sue, again, for, as you said, several years in a row. We really appreciate your insights. We'll probably see you again next year. Sue, I think, is able to hang around for just a little bit if there are any final follow-up questions at the end. But at this point, it's time for us to move on to our third policy update of the morning. Our policy partner next up is Susie Emmert. So Susie has also been with us in the past and actually in a previous role. So Susie, you can remind people where you've been in the past. Susie is an LSW, so she's another social worker in our midst. And she's currently Senior Director of Advocacy and Public Policy for Hennepin Healthcare System. Susie's a licensed graduate social worker, and her direct practice background is in independent living skills and Medicaid waiver case management, and her advocacy background includes over 10 years of advocacy at the Minnesota State Capitol and the federal level on behalf of issues related to health and human services. So Susie is an expert in our midst, absolutely. We really appreciate it. The social worker was so strong policy advocacy chops. We're going to give you about 10 minutes also, Susie, and then we'll have about 5 minutes for some Q&A. I will keep us on time, however, because we've heard from the Lieutenant Governor's office that she is ready to roll as soon as we're ready for her too. So that's lovely. So Susie, if you could talk about, I think, you know, from a healthcare perspective, we had planned to have you with us anyway for Day at the Capitol, but I think it's more important than ever for folks, especially those who are working or thinking about our healthcare sector in particular. So talk a little bit about what you're working on right now, what's been achieved, and what are you holding now for next year, and what can we do, what can we advocate on in the coming days and months ahead? So go right ahead, Susie.
Great, thank you so much, Karen. And thank you everybody for being on this call this morning. And I just wanna first say, I hope everyone's taking really good care of yourselves right now. This is a stressful time for all of us. And, you know, even if you're like me and you've been sitting at home for weeks, it's still a stressful time. So I hope everyone is doing what they need to do to take care of themselves. So as Karen had mentioned, I've been at NASW a number of times over the last decade. Formerly, I was with Lutheran Social Service of Minnesota as the chief advocacy officer there. And a year ago tomorrow, actually, I started at Hennepin Healthcare System as the Senior Director of Advocacy and Public Policy. So I really went from kind of a community-based perspective to a hospital-based perspective. So there has been just a ton to learn there, and I've loved it over the last year, kind of stretching myself into those other areas. So kind of pre-COVID, so PC, but everything has been COVID the last month, but I have been working for about the last 3 years to convene the coalition called This is Medicaid, and we've been really focused on all issues, primarily protecting Medicaid. This legislative session, as far as Hennepin Healthcare goes, I was working on recuperative care for people experiencing homelessness, so that's a place that people can go to within a shelter and get those services that they need for medical care. And so that has been kind of put on the back burner right now, along with extending Medicaid to a year postpartum for moms, and rather than just 60 days. So that's where most of our efforts were going. You know, just about a month ago, I was actually in Washington, D.C. It was a Wednesday. We were talking about COVID because it was starting to get more attention, and it was starting to become really clear this was going to really be a big change for all of us. And so that was on a Wednesday. We were talking to all of our congressional delegation about that, and talking about the need to protect Medicaid in this time, and that with such an approaching challenge as COVID, that we really needed to protect Medicaid. And so we were some of the last folks to visit Washington, D.C. and meet with our members of Congress. And the very next day, we were told, or the very next day, Congress actually closed. And so it was quite a shock there. But on the federal side, where we've really been focused has been the CARES Act that was passed a couple of weeks ago. There was $100 billion for hospitals included in the CARES Act, and some of that funding has already started to roll down. And then we're also working on a phase four bill with our members of Congress that would invest additional funding in hospitals. It would protect Medicaid from some of the proposed changes at the federal level, and a number of other things. So this legislative session, you know, I love listening to Marie and Sue talk about all the things that have been moving, and I just love my colleagues are so wonderful, and then they're so fantastic and know so much. I learn so much every time. But what I'm going to talk a little bit about is kind of what's happened with the COVID funding. There's been a number of investments already this legislative session. The first was about $21 million to the Department of Health. And that was for them to really kind of ramp up their operations. And then $200 million to the Department of Health as well for grants. So the first $50 million was set aside to be emergency grants. And those have been awarded. My hospital, for example, received $5 million of that $50 million. So we're very thrilled about that. And we ended up getting that funding for increased testing capacity in our labs for COVID cases, and then also for PPE and other technology investments and some staffing. So that of that $50 million, there were I think over $300 million in applications. So that left there of the $200 million, $150 million is still on the table for longer term funding. And so with that, we will be applying for that as well. MDH, I believe, has either just posted the application or is about to. So those are kind of the big funding issues where we've all kind of needed to redirect our efforts there on that MDH application. Legislators have kind of said that, you know, $200 million invested, that's where we're going to sit right now. Get through that. If we still need more money, we'll appropriate more money at that time. However, you know, that still leaves a lot of things on the table. You know, a lot of community-based services and others aren't necessarily eligible for that money. And the fact that we had $300 million in applications for $50 million speaks volumes about the level of need that's out there. So we were asked to talk a little bit about, you know, what we think can be teed up for next session. And I think we're going to be dealing with COVID and not just, I think we'll be dealing with COVID for quite a while. The repercussions of some of these initial investments, certainly, and a lot of other challenges ongoing. We do hope to get back to recuperative care for people experiencing homelessness. And the other thing I just want to say is, you know, this has really shined a bright light on inequity, a bright light on how our systems are not actually working. So something that we can do, I think, is really learn from what we've learned here in this crisis and hopefully do better. It's shined a bright light on our current healthcare system, the way it's structured, that it doesn't necessarily work for a lot of people. And we do not need to go back to the status quo. You know, this isn't hopefully about getting back to where we were. This is about doing better. So I want to think about that and encourage you to kind of incorporate that into your thinking about the future. So some things that we can talk about today and in the coming weeks is we are going to need additional investments in healthcare right now. Our hospitals were operating on very thin margins as it was, and with the cancellation of elective surgeries and a lot of other work being shut down, that's going to be really, really difficult there. Telehealth, Sue had talked a lot about community-based services and telehealth, especially our mental health services out in the community. And, you know, I could not agree more. Where we are challenged, especially as a safety net hospital, Hennepin Healthcare, where we are challenged is 30% of our patients actually, you know, no-shows are pretty consistent. We have a lot of folks who are experiencing pretty significant housing instability, a lot of folks who are experiencing challenges with food insecurity, employments, all kinds of issues. Telehealth is incredibly important for those folks, and we really see, you know, that there is a difference, as Sue mentioned, between the telephone and video. A lot of folks, either they don't have phones or they may have a phone that does not have video capability. And even if they did have video capability, many of these third-party vendors like Zoom, FaceTime and others, they require really strong Wi-Fi. I mean, I know my Wi-Fi isn't even always strong, and I am very well positioned in a very nice home with consistent Wi-Fi, and I still have challenges. So other issues, my chart is an English-only application, and so that is a big challenge for a lot of folks. So even if you have access to that technology, using my chart is really difficult for that video capability. There's a lot of challenges there. The other thing is the phone reimbursement is lower than the video reimbursement. We want to incentivize providers to, you know, make that effort to reach out to folks by the telephone and be able to, you know, we see this as an opportunity to be able to really connect with those folks that we've had a hard time keeping those appointments with because of all the challenges in their lives and transportation, trying to get to their appointments. All of that is really, really, we see this as an opportunity and hopefully an opportunity to not return to the status quo. We know that, the costs are going to far exceed what has been allocated. Hospitals and healthcare systems are major employers for a lot of social workers as well. They are very important in the greater Minnesota economic infrastructure. And the other thing is we want to see investments in community services like Sue was talking about. Frankly, hospitals want to keep people out of the hospitals right now. That's best for the safety of our staff. That's best for the safety of citizens. We want to make sure that people are doing that. The other thing I will say is staying at home is really key right now. And we know that there is a lot of pressure to open up and get the economy moving again. We understand that. However, we cannot do that without appropriate PPE for our healthcare workers and our first responders, without significant testing, without, you know, the healthcare workers that we need. They're on the front lines. We need them to be well protected. So before we can safely open, we want to make sure that those things are in place. And that might be something that you hear from the Lieutenant Governor as well. We're very grateful for all of these executive orders that Sue had mentioned from the governor putting into place. They've been absolutely helpful and urgent, especially around giving DHS and MDH authority to do more of what they need to do, orders around telehealth and mental health. We are very, very pleased with those. The last thing I'll just add, there's a lot of work from our coalition. This is Medicaid, and maybe Shireen or somebody could put it in the chat, but this is Medicaid. Our Twitter handle is at This is Medicaid. So please follow us there if you want to stay connected. We are tweeting all the time about what's happening here at the state level. So with that, I'm gonna wrap it up and see if there's any questions, or if we might need to go directly to the Lieutenant Governor. That's okay too.
Hold on, what? Yeah. Thanks so much, Susie. Really appreciate your thoughts. I think this framing around the healthcare situation is really important right now. And as you said, like, there are lots of ongoing things that we can't ignore, and things that we will come back to as the year and the days go ahead. We're not quite ready for the Lieutenant Governor yet, so we will go to a couple of questions for Susie. So Lauren, you wanna jump in, and thanks so much, and share a couple questions from our audience.
Yes, this is a question from Rochelle, and she's joining us from Duluth, where a hospital system recently placed 500 employees on unpaid admin leave with a chance that the leave will be permanent. So she's asking, is there an effort, perhaps through criteria of grants, to retain hospital workers as paid employees despite loss of revenue due to suspension of elective services?
I think that is such a good point, Rochelle, and it is such a challenge statewide that we are seeing in our hospital and healthcare systems. I can't speak directly to the hospital, absolutely, in Duluth, but I can tell you that there are tons of efforts going on right now to redeploy staff, to find ways to keep people engaged. You know, I think it speaks to some of the comments that have been made by Representative Edelson, talking about the hazard pay, about workers' comp. You know, those are really significant issues that we're seeing. And I think that these are very much top of mind, and it really speaks to the overall challenge that exists right now as far as the situation that we're in. The lack of elective surgeries, my understanding, I think, is the last number I saw was over the next few weeks, hospitals are expected to lose like $3 billion or over the next couple of months. I mean, it is a number that is really difficult to even wrap your head around. So I wish I had a better answer. I can tell you that there is lots of discussion and conversation amongst all of the hospitals, especially through the Minnesota Hospital Association, about how to address these issues. And ultimately, we will need, I think, legislators to step in and provide additional funding. I think that $150 million that MDH has set aside will be very helpful, but I feel like that's more of a, it's designated as kind of a longer term funding, but I think it's gonna be kind of gobbled up by our immediate needs here still. So we would love to see additional investment there, and for the legislature to step up and help maintain some of the infrastructure now. I wish I had a better answer.
Yeah, let's just try to get to one more before the Lieutenant Governor joins us. This is from Kyla. She asks, what can we do to advocate for improving internet and device availability for people who need access to telehealth mental health treatment services?
Yes, I think talk to your legislators and your communications today. You know, I've heard from a number of social workers in my institution alone about that. I know there are there's been a few changes that have happened from the Wi-Fi and internet side, as far as folks as internet providers offering, you know, free internet for a certain amount of time, you know, lifting some of those data restrictions, that kind of thing. And those are really important. However, I think that we need to keep talking about this. I fear that we get out of this and we don't learn anything from this. And some of these examples that we've talked about around, especially telehealth, it is so clear that this is the crisis that, you know, hopefully will shed such a light on that, but we have to connect those dots for elected officials. And so absolutely, when you make your questions today, please talk to elected officials about the real world, frankly. You know, that is one thing that I have often learned over the last decade, is there's sort of a disconnection about what, you know, folks, especially the folks that you work with, about what it really means, that like a few bucks really does matter. If something costs a few dollars more, that actually does impact somebody's ability to have access to it. And sometimes that isn't clear. And so I can't emphasize enough that you get to be the expert on that. And so sharing that story about, you know, we take for granted our good Wi-Fi in our houses. A lot of people don't have that. And here's what it looks like when they don't have that. You know, God, I think about all these school kids home right now that don't have good Wi-Fi. And it just breaks my heart. But I would absolutely emphasize the need for telehealth, and like, you know, from Sue's perspective that she talked about, and from that hospital perspective as well, this is how we're going to be able to reach people that really need some help right now. Mm-hmm. So anything we can do to break down those barriers is going to be really important.
And I think this is a really important time where, you know, we always say that stories are important, but anecdotal evidence is so important right now, that when we say, you know, yes, kids are affected, yes, there are, you know, mentally ill folks that need to talk with their therapists and don't have it, like, who are we talking about? Let's put a name and a face and a, you know, a real person behind that story. And if you know there are many of them, you know, giving some sort of sense of what that looks like and what the effect is, that matters absolutely right now. And I think this assumption that just because it seems like a big issue and everyone should know about it, doesn't necessarily mean, you know, if the story about all of the cuts at the hospital in Duluth hasn't hit the strib yet, then there are likely lots of people and people in power who don't even know that that's happening, much less, you know, social workers who are working in hospitals who have had to go and work from home and are being cut and furloughed and all of those sorts of things, that people are like, oh, I thought hospital people were working in the cities, you know. And so we need every one of those stories. We need it. Our legislators need to hear it so that we can all tell that important collective story together too. So yes. Yeah, absolutely. Lauren, did we have any more questions from our audience for Susie? Great.
Sorry, I'm muted. Muting myself because my dog was crying. We have one more. So she says, you mentioned the thin margins of hospitals and healthcare and the need for more funds. However, some salaries in healthcare are so disproportionately high. For example, hospital directors and doctors. Mm-hmm. How can the public have some say in salary equity within healthcare when there's this big discrepancy between high-ranking people getting paid and then layoffs?
Mm-hmm. I think that is such a good question, and it is a question across the country for how we do that. And I think it's a very good example of our very flawed healthcare system. So what I have seen among all of this work in healthcare reform is, you know, you kind of squeeze the balloon or you fix something in one spot and it, you know, blows up in another spot. It expands in another spot. And so I think that salaries, I think, are a really good example of that. And certainly some health systems are better and more equitable than others. But it is an overall issue related to our entire health system across the country. And so I can't speak to specific things right now as far as where we are today in this, but I would say that it is overall an issue nationally that needs to be addressed if we're ever going to figure out how to do healthcare in this country, because we don't have it figured out right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So many big things and little things, big things to all of us. So thank you so much, Susie, for being with us for another Social Work Day at the Capitol, or Online Advocacy Day. We really appreciate your insights. I love that you stayed in Minnesota and kept all of these connections to places, and it's a great through line for us. So we're thrilled to have you with us and hope to see you again soon. All right. Thanks so much, Susie. All right. Thanks, Lauren. Lauren will be back again after a little bit until we hear from the governor's office, which we haven't quite yet. Excuse me, I have multiple Q&A things going here. All right. Until we hear from the governor's office. We just heard from the governor's office. All right, we are going to move forward. and hear from Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan. So let's go ahead and get her on.
Good morning, everybody.
Hello, good morning. Hi. Thanks so much for being with us. I'm going to do just a little bit of a welcome for you. And while I do that, if you could share your webcam with us, we'd love to see your face this morning, if you're okay with that.
Yeah.
Folks, Lieutenant Governor Flanagan is a great friend of social workers. She is a mom, an organizer, a member of the White Earth Band of Ojibwe. And on November 6, 2018, she was elected the 50th Lieutenant Governor of Minnesota. She's dedicated her life to giving back, particularly to children, families, communities of color, Native Americans, and low-income and working people. As a former state representative and community organizer, she brings her experiences of building coalitions and advocating for children and families to the Lieutenant Governor's office. As I said, she is a great friend of social workers. She's a great listener, and we're thrilled to have her with us today. Peggy, we have about 10 minutes or so for you to share some thoughts with. We're at nearly 800 social workers from across Minnesota with us online this morning. So welcome.
Thank you so much, Karen, for having me. And for folks who don't know, Karen and I went to high school together. So it's always good to see her. But thank you again, everyone, for allowing me this opportunity to join you this morning from the Lieutenant Governor's residence in my kitchen, which has become my workspace. And I know probably for many of you, you have makeshift spaces as well. But I wanted to just send greetings on behalf of Governor Walz. He cares tremendously about the work that you do every day, as do I. And this is one of my favorite events, usually at the Capitol. And so I'm glad that we've been able to take this online. During this really unprecedented time of pandemic, we know that you are risking, many of you are risking your lives to help vulnerable communities get what they need. And I wanted to let you know that the governor and I see you and we value you, and we are so appreciative of that work. You are a really critical piece of making sure that Minnesota is a great place to live through schools and hospitals, mental health clinics, and really in support of our families and communities. There's certainly a great diversity of tasks that you perform to help people who are struggling with some aspect of their lives. And for many people, I think what I've heard certainly folks say that somehow that COVID-19 or the coronavirus is a great equalizer. But I actually think that's false. What this virus has done has really laid bare the inequities in our state with regards to race or socioeconomic status or geography. And so I know that you are on the front lines of that every day, and we want to be as conscious of that as possible as we are trying to make incredibly difficult decisions to keep Minnesotans safe. And whether it's people who are experiencing domestic violence, connecting with low-income families and families of color, or supporting those who are experiencing homelessness, you are always fighting for justice for folks and making sure that people have their needs met. And again, that's why Governor Walz and I have made sure that people who are enrolled in public programs do not lose their coverage during the course of this pandemic, and are opening up, as many of you know, a special enrollment period at MnSure that allows people who are currently uninsured to enroll and try to get coverage. We've also been successful in eliminating out-of-pocket costs for testing and treatment of the virus in our public programs and in many insurance plans for people who buy coverage on their own and get it through their employer. The legislature approved $200 million in healthcare grants in their last COVID-19 response bill to provide to providers to prepare for and respond to the outbreak. And we are currently working hard to ensure that we have personal protective equipment or PPE for every healthcare worker, emergency services worker, and everyone else who's on the front lines to keep people healthy and accessing the services that they need. But all that being said, in some instances, we are falling short. And in many ways, that is frankly, due to the lack of preparedness coming from the federal government. So in many ways, we have our Commissioner Alice Roberts Davis, who's the head of the Department of Administration, has been now put in charge of procurement of getting personal protective equipment and making sure that that is getting across the state. And I'd encourage you as much as you can to visit our website, which we update frequently. We also have a COVID-19 dashboard site and a way to just stay connected with all of you when the way that we do that is primarily virtually. So I can only imagine what you all are experiencing right now, and you are in my thoughts and my prayers, and the governor and I are cheering you on and just want to be in communication as much as possible, which is why, Karen, I'm so glad that we had this opportunity today. I will mention two additional pieces that I think are really critical to stability and want to encourage you, the 800 social workers who are on this call, to do what you can to communicate with your legislators on two really important issues. As you may know, the governor signed an executive order that prohibited the eviction of people from their homes during the state of emergency, which has been really important because we need people to stay home, to stay healthy and safe, but also to stop the spread of coronavirus and give us some time to prepare to make sure that we have the ICU facilities, the ventilators needed, and just additional healthcare capacity to respond to the people who will inevitably contract COVID-19, which is why we've been asking people to stay at home. But that executive order has been really critical. But we've also heard from folks calling for additional support for people who may have lost their jobs, have been furloughed, and others who may have been already sort of teetering on economic stability. And so there's a couple of things that we've done. One, we made sure that we've had a robust response in our unemployment insurance, and that's been really important. We've already been able to do the top off for folks who have been laid off of the $600 from the federal government. But the two things that you could take action on right now would be asking legislators to give a one-time payment to families who are in MFIP, the Minnesota Family Investment Program, of $500. That money is already there in TANF funds. It simply requires the legislature to allocate those funds to families. And folks who are on this call know that that can go towards making sure that people can purchase diapers, additional food, toilet paper, all those things that are so necessary for families right now who may be stretched pretty thin. And the other thing is ask for a call to action around rental assistance. We know that this is a tough time for folks, and this is one of the ways that the legislature could respond with additional assistance for folks so that people can remain in their homes, but also so that landlords can also have the economic support that they need as well. So those would just be two asks. I could not resist the opportunity to ask for your additional advocacy, as I know that you are on the front lines working with families and with individuals every single day who oftentimes are the most vulnerable folks in our state. So again, we are just grateful for your service now more than ever before. Encourage you to continue to work with us and to reach out whenever possible, and to continue to advocate for the folks that you work with every single day. I'm so grateful and honored in this moment to be able to be your Lieutenant Governor, and just know how important it is that you all are working to help individuals meet their own needs, but also knowing how critical all of you will be and social workers will be as we work towards recovery. And what has been laid bare is that the most vulnerable people in our community, have been deeply affected by this virus, but also know that we have an opportunity as we move forward in recovery to center the people who are most vulnerable as we work to rebuild and recover from this crisis together. So Chimi Gritch, thank you so much for the work that you have done and the work that you will do to help support Minnesotans and also to help them recover.
Absolutely. Peggy, I cannot thank you enough for being with us this morning. I want to say before I just say a couple other things regarding your remarks, I just have to throw out some condolences to you for the loss of your brother. I know that COVID-19 has hit your family especially hard, and there are condolences pouring into the chat while you were talking, and so I just wanted to share that with you.
Thank you so much. And this is my story, very shortly, will not be unique, as we know that there are many people across the country and across the state who have lost a loved one. I've told folks that my brother was a Marine who cared tremendously about service and serving people, and he would have said, girl, get back to it. And so my family will find time to mourn and to more memorialize my brother. But right now we have work to do. And I know that so many people on this call, you are doing the same thing. All of our lives, I have a first grader, and so distance learning for so many of us. Yeah. A challenge, but just knowing that we're all doing the best that we can in the face of just tremendous adversity. So I appreciate that so much from your members.
Well, we appreciate you and your strength and your tenacity and willingness to say what needs to be said and do what needs to be done. You have been known for that for a long time, and we appreciate having a friend in the governor's office as well. Governor Walz is supported by NASW and will continue to be, and we're thrilled. I think that you taking your moment to share a couple of things that you would ask us to keep asking the legislators, remembering that power lies in many levels in our policymaking process. And so you actually echoed something that we heard from House Member Edelson earlier this morning around additional funds for rental assistance and mortgage assistance and whatnot. So that is absolutely an ask people need to be. And that one-time payment of $500 for those on MFIP. We finally raised MFIP just a teeny tiny bit. But the needs that we're all facing at this time are immense. And so I think that could go a long ways for helping some folks as well. So I appreciate that nudge, and appreciate you being with us this morning, Peggy. Thank you for all you do. Have a fantastic rest of your day.
Thank you. Take good care, everybody.
Hey, you too. Thank you. All right, folks. With that, we are going to spend just a few minutes on a few additional pieces of policy work that NASW Minnesota is working on. I wanted to just make sure that we cover a few things that in addition to all of the work that you're all doing, that all of our policy partners are doing, NASW works on all kinds of things. And so in our policy work at the chapter, we take it very seriously that, okay, first of all, social workers care about lots of things, right? As you can hear this morning, everything from housing to healthcare to welfare reform to mental health to, just the whole gamut of things, right? And NASW is your national association, and it is our job to look out for you. So we are advocating for the needs of social workers in the midst of all of these other things and the issues that you care about and affect your ability to do your work. I just wanna highlight a few things that are happening currently that we've been working on, and this is just a real quick snapshot. So first of all, social workers are essential. So I want to say right up front that in all of the legislation that came out right away against around COVID-19, that social workers were specifically called out both at the state level and the national level as essential workers. And I just love that. It makes my heart warm. And I know we all know that, but we don't always realize that everyone else realizes it too. Many of you are also doing advocacy work on your own for your own needs. I just want to call out the work that, so many of you have called me, emailed me, said, here's some things we're working on. Can you get behind this? Can you help with this? Write a letter, do those things. And we are absolutely doing those things. Both big and little things. I wanted to specifically call out the work of Professor Nancy Fitzsimmons and her fantastic students in her social policy course at MSU Mankato. We've added several policy briefs to our online resources for today. So in your Google Docs, there's a folder that says MSU Mankato. That's with our other policy partners. And they, in their course, had worked on policy briefs that are for current issues happening right now. There is one on police social work in Minnesota, one on criminal justice reform and the need to support children and families and communities that are impacted by punitive practices. One on achieving equity for African-American children and families in the child welfare system, and one for modernizing our Minnesota guardianship statute. I know her course has some others that will be coming out as well, and I will keep adding those to the folder. In addition, I know several of our other schools of social work have students that are working on policy briefs on, and if you're working on anything that is related to real life issues that are happening right now, I really don't want that to be an activity that you do and you turn into a professor and then it goes nowhere, because we all need additional content and information and that sort of thing. And so if you could share those back with me with the chapter, you could send them to admin.naswmn@socialworkers.org. We can make sure that those get shared with folks from today as well as in the future. So just a few things that are important for everyone to hear about our work related to the Board of Social Work. I know there's still a lot of misunderstanding out there about the difference between the Board of Social Work and NASW. So I just want to clarify that real quick. So the Board of Social Work is a government agency, folks. So these are the folks that our government employs to oversee the work of social workers and protect the public. So they're our licensing body. So when social workers came together and with NASW in 1987 and got licensure passed in Minnesota, that created then the Board of Social Work, okay? So the Board of Social Work is not NASW, we're very different beings. However, we work very closely together. We are partners on a lot of things. I lobby them on your behalf on all sorts of things and work very closely with the board. I attend all of their board meetings and try to keep a pulse on things. I also lead advisory committee of the board, and I've also been on the legislative and rules committee of the board. Just want to make sure we're super clear. We're different. They're protecting the public and overseeing licensure. NASW is here to support social workers. We write the code of ethics. We advocate on things on behalf of social workers. Just a couple things that have happened related to the Board of Social Work, just so everyone's up to date. There was a licensure bill at the legislature this session that was just going gangbusters, and we were super excited about it. And this is the work of that legislative and rules committee I was talking about. So there's a committee at the Board of Social Work that's been looking at our whole licensing laws over the last 2 years and making all kinds of recommended changes to it, things to bring it up to today's language, to really make it more accessible for social workers, especially online sorts of things and whatnot, just all kinds of things that need to be updated in our licensure laws. The changes had passed with flying colors through the committees at both the House and Senate. However, they have not gone to floor vote, which means that we likely won't pass it this legislative session unless this falls under the purview of things that the legislature takes very seriously in the next few weeks. But so it's something you could absolutely say to your legislators, we'd really like to see the social work licensing bill passed. That's all you have to tell them. It's already in the mix. In addition, the Board of Social Work passed three things rather quickly related to COVID-19. One is related to continuing ed, so extending so that there's no limit for independent study hours that social workers can have at renewal in 2022. So the next time you renew your license, instead of about just under half of your hours being allowed through independent study, this time around, because of COVID-19, all of your hours can be done like this through independent study, or in things that are not live as well. Your supervision can also be done through phone or electronic media through 2022. And then application close dates were extended by 6 months. Now then, just a couple of other things. One that also passed that we've been working on, I've been hearing from social workers from actually across the country who are doing clinical practice with folks, especially students who were in schools across the country and then suddenly had to come home to Minnesota. And those social workers did not have licenses to practice in Minnesota, so thus could not continue to even meet with their clients through telehealth. And so on April 6th, Governor Wall signed an emergency executive order. It's Executive Order 20-28, allowing out-of-state mental health providers to render telehealth services during our peacetime emergency. So they have to go through a registration process that's fairly simple. They can do that through the Board of Social Work online. And then while we're in the state of emergency, can keep serving clients in Minnesota. So that's important for all social workers to know too, that if someone comes to you and says, I can't meet with my therapist from across the country, they technically could, and people across the country might not all know that that's allowed. So we just wanna make sure that people realize that that happened. And then there's one particular area that I know, there's probably several, but there's one in particular that does not have a solution yet that I know is concerning many of you. And that is the concern about students not being able to take their Board of Social Work exams. So those ASWB exams that we're all required to take in order to practice and get a license. So a couple things. One is we know this has a lot of stress on students. There's a crazy amount of ambiguity right now. The Board of Social Work does not have the purview to change this. It would have to be an order from the governor. I want to say that although I've been hearing from lots of social workers that this is a concern and students and faculty members, the Board of Social Work has not been hearing from you. And so they've said, you know, we've heard from a couple people, but it hadn't been an onslaught of concern pouring out. And so I think that if students and faculty members are really concerned about this, I want you to reach directly out to the Board of Social Work, our Minnesota Board of Social Work, and let them know that this is a concern and that we need to do something about this. I want to also just update you and say that effective April 7th, Pearson View added, so Pearson, who's the testing centers, added ASWB candidates, so social work candidates for exam, added them to the list of essential workers who are allowed to test for licensure in a subset of test centers that have been opened on a limited basis during basically the shutdown that's happening. So you can schedule your appointments at these test centers. You have to do it through their online process like you normally would. For any further cancellations that they have, they're waiving the registration change fee, which is helpful. But we're in the process of inquiring about current testing sites in Minnesota that are still testing. And as we learn more about that, we will absolutely let you know. Just a couple things. If you're members of NASW, you should be getting newsletters from us. If you're licensed in Minnesota, you should be getting all kinds of updates from the board, from NASW as well. And anyone who wants to hear from us, you can email our office and let us know that you want to be on our mailing list, and we will put you on our general all social worker mailing list. The other great place to stay connected to really timely updates from NASW Minnesota is to be our friend on Facebook. So a lot of these things, as they roll out, we post them first to Facebook. It's the easiest, slickest sort of thing. But if we're not showing up in your feed, you might need to go to our page and check out what's there every so often. All right, so we'll keep you up to date on that. We also have a significant amount of work we're doing on some ADHD and PTSD diagnosis issues where social workers are not able to diagnose those for funding purposes, whatnot. We're not going to get into that today because it's not as pertinent in the current issues that are happening, but you'll hear more from us in the weeks and months and especially the year ahead as we go into the next session when we'll work really hard on that again. So with that, and I'm going to hold any questions that are coming up right now for later. So if you have other questions for our policy partners, we'll ask that you go ahead and you can put those into the chat. We will do our best to answer those in the days ahead through our Facebook page in particular. You all saw the contact information and we can send it out to everyone also for each of our policy partners that spoke this morning. They're all very interested in hearing from you and getting those anecdotal stories and being helpful with information. So we will connect you up with folks. But just for time purposes, we're going to keep moving with our morning here. And at this time, we are going to move real quickly. Hold on, let me get my stuff together here. We're going to move real quickly to Shireen Retta at the NASW office, who is going to talk about everyday advocacy. Shireen, are you with us?
Yes. Can you hear me?
I can.
Great. Good morning, everybody. My name is Shireen Retta. I'm the chapter coordinator with NASW Minnesota. There's a good chance that if you've ever called our office or emailed that admin email address, we've been in connection before. So thank you all for being here today. We've heard a lot of really good information. There's so many different issues that we're all paying attention to in our regular time, let alone right now in the midst of COVID-19. So it can feel like, you know, you might be asking yourself, where do I start and how do I take action and what do I need to do? Thankfully, we've had so many great speakers talk about the importance of keeping engaged during this time. And we can't let the fact that we can't get to the Capitol right now slow us down in any way, shape, or form. So we're going to talk about everyday advocacy. It's not just about social work day at the Capitol. This is everyday advocacy that we're going to talk about. It's about engaging in action where you live and work, making it a regular part of what you're doing. You don't need to go to the Capitol to do it. You don't have to have a specific bill or policy in mind. You heard all of our policy partners say today that you don't need to be an expert in any subject. If you're a human being, which I think we all are, who cares about the issues and realities that affect you and the people that you serve in your community and your loved ones, then you're already qualified to advocate. Every issue and cause that you care about has a policy aspect to it. So we're going to make it really simple for you to just hone in on an issue and take your first actions to advocate, okay? Some of this might be review for some of you, but a refresher is always good. I even learned some new things as I was preparing for today. So stick with us, folks. Social workers are actually all taught the same problem-solving method. Little quiz for y'all from engagement determination. And guess what, folks? That same method applies in advocacy because advocacy is social work. Let's talk about it. Karen did go to the next slide already. Great. So this is where we start. Being curious. This is the engagement part of advocacy. You're basically choosing an issue or a topic on which to advocate. Again, the flood of all the things that we care about and that we want to take action on. We have to narrow it down somehow. So you're more likely to take action on something in which you have some kind of personal stake, particularly if there's maybe an emotional investment. This could be the current work that you're doing in your job or your place of practice or your field placement or internship, mental health care, youth development, whatever the case might be. Maybe it's something that affects you personally on a day-to-day basis, like healthcare access, or, you know, in my case, student loan debt, the cost of education. Maybe it's something that has just been really close to your heart throughout your life. For me, again, environmental justice and immigration are two things that I hold really close to my heart and that I try to keep tabs on and engage in often. Everybody has something like that that they're passionate about. There's no shortage of issues that as a profession, we care about. So I want you all to just ask yourself this question right now. What is one issue about which I am passionate? We're going to try and narrow it down to one. If you're being flooded with ideas the way that I usually am, just pick the first one that comes to mind or the one that just is like, oh, I can't seem to like move on from this one. It could be a personal one or a professional issue. And I want you to just focus on this issue. Keep it in mind as we keep moving through the rest of this everyday advocacy section. Karen, can you go to the next one, please? Awesome. Okay. So you've got your issue in mind. You're bringing to mind the factors now that somehow impact the outcome or the experience of people who are impacted by that issue that you have in mind. What does that mean? It means that it's assessment time. We are trying to think now about the challenges that are consistently there when we're thinking about this issue. Maybe, you know, I'm thinking about in my internship placement or my practice setting, all of my clients, while they're not seeing me for homelessness, are experiencing homelessness. Maybe the majority of them are experiencing some kind of mental health crisis. What are those themes and patterns and challenges that are consistently there? And what are the barriers that you consistently run into as you're trying to serve those folks? And if you're thinking of a personal issue, what are the issues that you consistently run into? So if it's a service setting, maybe the folks that you're serving don't qualify for a particular type of assistance or program that's being offered. And maybe that limits your ability to help them to get their needs met. So what does that look like for the issue that you have in mind? Those patterns, those gaps, those barriers are indicative of a gap, something missing in the current systems and structures, and they are a great place to start planting those seeds of policy. When you have consistent patterns, we can start looking at numbers. When we have a large number of people experiencing something, we have data that we can use to bring about action. At the same time, we all know that we have that one client, that one family, or that one person in your life that we just can't serve as well as we can the others. Someone that stands out, like this yellow tulip in the field of purple and pink, right? Someone who experiences a little bit more barriers, or it's a little bit more of a challenge to really get their needs equitably met. And as social workers, we serve those most vulnerable people, the people that are on the margins. And those standout cases, those exceptions, if you will, need advocacy too, arguably more advocacy. So where there's one exception, you can bet there are several more just like them. So we have to keep in mind, what are the patterns and what are the standouts? And how do we advocate for that? How does that apply to the issue that you have in your mind right now? Karen, can you go to the next one, please? Okay, we've engaged, we've assessed, so now what? You have thoughts, you have ideas, it's time to plan. Okay, and you have more tools at your disposal than you may realize. Okay, we put a few of them up on the slide here. We've been sharing them in the chat throughout the presentation today. The first place to start when it comes to actual legislation and policies that are going on is the Minnesota Legislature website. And the URL is right here. You can also just go to Google and type in Minnesota Legislature or who represents me, and it will pop up right away. With that information. It's really straightforward to find. So you can start by looking up who actually represents me in the House and Senate here in Minnesota, who represents me in DC in the House and Senate. Let's not forget about them too. This is also, this legislature website is also where you can look up different bills that are going on in the state. And you can actually look it up by your area of interest. Did you know that you could do that? So you don't even have to have a particular bill in mind, House file, you know, 2170 or whatever the case might be. That's great if you do. You can definitely keep tabs on that. But you can also just go to the website and say affordable housing and do a keyword search, and it will come up with a ton of results for you about what's actually happening in the legislature at present. There's also a really great tool on the Minnesota legislature website for tracking bills. It's called My Bills, and you create a little account, and it allows you to keep tabs on those bills in which you have a vested interest. We put some instructions, including screenshots, in the Google Drive resource folder about how to access the My Bills. You also will find in that Google Drive the NASW Minnesota legislative agenda, as well as the NASW national priorities for advocacy. You may have a legislative or policy agenda from your own organization that can serve as a source of inspiration for you. So check out those agendas, check out the ones of our policy partners that we've shared in the Google Drive. And I keep mentioning the Google Drive, which is full of goodies as well, includes how to talk to your legislators, instructions for how to track the bills online. That link was emailed out to everybody. We have gotten some questions about sharing that Google Drive link again. We will do so after today's event. if not throughout the rest of the presentation in the chat box. And I think we heard this implied a little bit from our presenters today. We know what the problems are, so we have ideas about what the solutions are. What ideas do you have for making change? So start with your own brain. It's stuffed full of potential. Can you go to the next one, Karen, please? Okay, so we've engaged, we've assessed, we've planned. Now is the time for intervention. This is where we take action, okay? So Representative Edelson mentioned that everything is currently about COVID-19 right now and meeting those necessities and things of that nature. And she also said that as social workers, we're already advocating for the most important issues. So it's not the time to slow down right now. We're gonna hear a little bit about how to use social media and how to build a relationship with your representative. So that's gonna be coming up. You can also propose a policy. I intend to connect with my representatives and suggest ideas to them about what I want to see. Representative Edelson was actually talking about giving us a solution, bring us the goodies. So you can actually propose something to your representative. There may or may not be something that they're currently working on or that they are able to support or work against. Bring them the ideas. You can also start in your own workplace by just organizing with your peers and colleagues. This is something that I've done in a couple of past work settings. You can start to influence what's happening in your organization, in your practice setting, by saying, hey, these are the patterns and the barriers that we're running up against as practitioners. These are the barriers and patterns that our clients that we're trying to serve are running up against. How can we as an organization do something to address that? Can we create a program? Can we develop a legislative agenda or add to it? Can we advocate as an organization or connect with others, form a coalition? Start in your practice setting with the folks that you're working with every day and involve your clients. Then after we've taken action, we've intervened, we have to ask ourselves, how did it go? Evaluate. When it comes down to it, you're going to act on the things that really mean something to you. So to simplify, just start with what you know and where you have a connection and where you have an interest. That's where you start advocating. You're going to learn something new every time you do it, which is going to make you more likely to do it again. Next one, Karen, please. Okay, so to summarize, advocacy is social work. The steps that you're using in your practice every day are the same steps that you use for advocacy. You engage by being curious and asking questions and identifying the issue. You assess by finding patterns, themes, and defining the problem. You plan by choosing tools to address what you need to do and what you need to know. You intervene by taking action where you live and practice every day. You evaluate by reflecting on how it went and how you can apply what you learned moving forward. I'm not going to talk about termination, but it's not going to be the focus right now. We want you to keep going, keep taking those actions. And remember that everything is a policy issue. There is no separation between micro and macro when it comes to policy. One informs the other and it just loops around. So ask yourself, what issues do you really care about? You are social workers. We want you to wear that proudly and ask yourself how you can use your social work power, as Representative Edelson called it, for everyday advocacy to help bring about change. I think with that said, we're turning it over now to Lauren Abdil, who's going to talk about how to use your social media to engage in everyday advocacy.
Can you go back one, Karen?
Sure.
There we go. Perfect. Thanks, Shireen. Yeah, I'm just going to talk a little bit about using social media as an advocacy tool. Before I went to grad school to get my MSW, I was a marketing manager for a mental health nonprofit in DC. So I got to do some of this work there. I want to start with saying that social media is a really powerful tool, but research still says that phone calls are and in-person visits are the most effective way to advocate. So social media, I like to think of it as it doesn't replace calling or going to visit your legislator, but it enhances it. So there's this concept called social listening that's evolved the last 10 years or so. And it's basically the idea that organizations and politicians and legislators need to be monitoring what their constituents or consumers are talking about on social media, because they are talking about it. So this has actually developed into an entire job for people who work in a legislative office or who work on a campaign. There's literally someone being paid to sit online and scroll and see what people are talking about, compile that information, and then pass it on to the candidate or the representative. So there's someone reading what you're seeing. So that's definitely important. People are looking for this content. A really easy thing everyone can do today to take some kind of action is, you know, look up who your representatives are and save their contact info in your phone, but also go ahead and find them on social media. Find their Twitter account or their Instagram account. The majority of them will have Twitter accounts. I would be surprised if there are any out there who don't. Instagram and Facebook, not as many have accounts there, but it's still worth checking, because if they do have an account, that's a place that you want to be following, commenting, tagging what you're doing. So tagging our legislators in tweets, Facebook posts, and Instagram posts is a really good way to hold them accountable and to sort of double up the impact of calling or visiting in person. So what I like to do is call my legislator. Pro tip, if you are a socially anxious person and you get anxious about speaking with, you know, a live person on the other end of the phone, someone told me once, just call after hours and leave a message. So I think that's a good idea if it's not time sensitive. But whenever you do call, after you've called and left a message or spoken with someone, go ahead and tweet or post on Facebook that you called them and that you had a conversation, and sort of share what you talked about or what views you expressed. This is a really good way to hold legislators accountable, because now they aren't the only ones who know that you called. Now all your followers know that you called too. And this is sort of anecdotal evidence. I don't have, you know, hard data on this, but I think I've gotten more of a response from legislators after I have tweeted about the phone call than if I just make a call and don't tweet about it. It sort of like reinforces the message. So pay attention to relevant hashtags. For people who don't know what hashtags are, they're the little like hash marks like that. And they essentially turn words into hyperlinks. So it curates content so that folks can click on, you know, a hashtag for hashtag mental health, and tons of tweets with regarding that topic will pop up. So definitely be paying attention to the hashtags that are important to whatever policy issue you focus on. In Minnesota, and this is interesting, I haven't seen this in other places, the hashtag MNLEG, which stands for Ledge Legislature, hashtag MNLEG, is used literally on every tweet about any piece of policy or anything that's moving through the legislature. So it's a really great, if you want to add, if you're commenting on something happening in the legislature, if you add that hashtag, it's going to be seen by a lot of people, including the people who are doing the social listening. So definitely include that if you're tweeting about things happening at the Capitol here in Minnesota. Some other ones that are popular, hashtag power of Medicaid is one that I don't know if Susie mentioned it directly, but it's a part of their Medicaid campaign. So if you're tweeting about Medicaid, you can use that. Hashtag defend democracy is another one that has to do with voting rights. So just do some research and see what's out there. Always tag NASW Minnesota so we can see what you're doing, and then retweet it or, you know, reshare it with our followers. It's basically, I feel like the purpose of social media isn't to just put out there what you're doing, it's to get it seen by as many people as possible. And so there are different tricks to do that, including using hashtags, you know, tweeting at your representative, including, you know, any organizations that are doing this work, including NASW Minnesota, so that they will see it and then retweet it to all their people. And then people who follow that hashtag will see that tweet and then they'll retweet it to all their people. So it's sort of about like putting the message out, but also putting it out in a way that other people are going to be able to find it and reshare it. And that's really the power of social media, is we're getting our messages out to all kinds of people. So Karen, if we could go next slide. Thank you. So this is just an example of a tweet from 2018 that I did. This was back when Crisis Connection sadly lost its funding. I was an intern for them. So I had left messages for them saying, like, we need to secure funding for Crisis Connection. Suicide prevention is so incredibly important. This is a life or death matter, all that stuff. And then I went ahead and tweeted, just left messages for, tagged my representatives in there, asking them to make sure House File 501 / Senate File 776 gets passed in the hashtag MN ledge. And then I included hashtag suicide prevention in there because that's a big hashtag that suicide prevention advocates use a lot. So just a quick example of what a tweet could look like. And then I think I had one more in there, Karen, next slide. Yes, so this was during the Kavanaugh confirmation hearings. I called Tina Smith and Amy Klobuchar. So this is another example of, you know, a kind of tweet that you could send following up after a call. And it doesn't always have to be like, you know, I called blah, 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 demanding that they do this. It can be like, I call them to say thank you and to say that, like, I'm with them and they're advocating for what I want them to be advocating for. So it doesn't always have to be like you're coming swinging at them. It can be really thankful, grateful tweet too. So that's just some thoughts for people to think about social media. It's really easy way to enhance your impact when you're doing advocacy. And I encourage folks to play around with it and experiment with it, definitely today and in the future if you don't already.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Lauren. Really appreciate you sharing your skills. I'm telling you guys, every time I hear from Lauren or I see something she's posted on Facebook, I'm just like, dang, girl, like I don't do that like that. So I appreciate you. I think we all have different ways that fit us personally to go about this advocacy work. And so what I want people to take from today too is it doesn't always have to be this fancy, like you have all the materials and you do all the things and you know all the details and stuff. Sometimes it's like getting your point across in a very simple, maybe it's a phone message as you're saying, following up with a tweet that calls them out and says, hey, I'm asking for this, and hopefully urges other people to do the same. And that's powerful stuff. And it's stuff most of us are doing, not all of us, some of us, I should say, are doing in our everyday lives naturally anyway. So I think that's really awesome. All right, at this point, we are heading into just a few minutes with our intern at NASW Minnesota, Beth, who is going to talk a bit about building a relationship with her legislator. So as Beth gets rolling here, I just wanted to say to folks, if you're on our social policy committees or you work in the NASW office, if you're tightly connected to us, I ask everyone to work on these personal relationships with your legislators, because it makes such a difference in terms of when we're ready to get to work. When we already have a relationship built with that person, it makes all the difference in the world. So it is very easy for any of us at NASW to call Heather Edelson because we have endorsed her and she knows us and we know her, and then she responds. And so, you know, one of the coolest things over the last few weeks for me, as we were moving into this COVID-19 stuff and trying to decide what to do with Faith Capital, I texted Heather and said, what do you know? What are you thinking? Is the legislature still going to be running? This was way before all of we knew what was exactly happening. And she texted me, and then we talked on the phone at like 10:30 at night one night. And that relationship matters, folks. So is Beth, are you with us?
Yes, I'm here.
Awesome. All right, folks, this is Beth Winterfeld. She's an MSW intern from MSU Mankato and has been working on building relationships for legislators. So Beth, share with us what you've learned.
Thank you, Karen. So what I'd like to say first is that this has been a really content-rich morning that I certainly, as a student, MSW student, have gained a lot from. And I appreciate every perspective that's been brought to the table. I would also like to say that I am approaching social work as a career change after being a musician, professional musician for 25 years. So my learning curve has been very sharp and very steep. And so it was not until February of this year that, because I was part of NASW Minnesota's Political Action Committee and the Social Political Action Network Committees, that I was challenged with meeting my legislators. And it was really that challenge that caused me for the first time in my life to reach out to my legislators. It was a really worthwhile experience for me. And so I'm sharing my experience as a way to let everybody listening right now to know that if I can do it, you can do it too. And some things that I did that I think made it easy and smooth. And really my motivation for doing this, as Karen had already mentioned, is that in anything I do in life, I really feel like it's valuable to have relationships. And so I am just in the initial steps of building relationships with my representative and my senator from District 19 down here in St. Peter, Minnesota. So what I did, because I knew nothing, was I did as Shireen suggested, and I went to the Google, and I just Googled names and contact information. And also, as Lauren had mentioned, being an anxious person, I was hoping not to get anybody on the phone, but I did. I called up Representative Brand first, and apparently I had called his cell phone because he answered. So I was prepared to say thank you and introduced myself. And basically before I called, I knew what my goal was, is that I wanted to meet them in person and have a conversation because I had a couple of talking points. So I used that phone call just to set up the meeting. And it was very helpful because Representative Brand also asked me if I wanted to meet with Senator Friends, also from our district, and I said, why, yes. So he said, well, I'm gonna call him for you and I'll, you know, make sure he's at our meeting too. So that was an extra bonus for me. I don't know that that's how it works in all districts. So in February, we were able to meet at a coffee shop in St. Peter, and I made sure I was on time. I made sure that I was dressed professionally, although I don't think that's required. And I offered to buy them coffee because I thought these people are public servants. They're representing me. They have taken time out of their day. So this is the least I can do. And at 8:15 in the morning, Representative Brand politely declined the coffee because I was his fourth meeting of the day, which was super impressive for me at all the hard work he's doing to meet with constituents. So as we met, again, as I said, the first thing I do is I said thank you. Thank you for working on behalf of me and your district. And then I had my talking points ready, which at that time were just simply sharing the NASW Minnesota chapter legislative agenda. And I had copies for them. I also took the opportunity to share a newspaper article about the personal story of Tim Berry, who was walking across Minnesota to build awareness for his daughter in prison with a traumatic brain injury and not getting the treatment she needs, which was the policy topic we were working on in policy class. And I was very impressed at the time that they didn't just take the papers and put them in their pockets, they actually read them while I was there. And then we used both of those as launching points for a wonderful conversation, which brings me to my next point, that it's really important, I think, for all of us at any time just to be who we are, to be our authentic selves. So there's a lot about politics and policy and advocacy that I do not know, that I'm still learning, and I will always be a learner. So when I was meeting with them, I did not pretend to know everything. And I stopped them and I asked questions and said, can you explain this to me again? Because the language is still pretty fresh for me. And I think that was a good thing to do because it gave me more, you know, kind of ownership and power, and that I was there willing to learn from them. So by the end of the meeting, they both willingly shared their cell phones with me, cell phone numbers with me, and encouraged me to be in further contact. So then what I did is I started to look for opportunities to do so in an authentic way. And the first thing I did was I wrote a handwritten thank you to each of them, thanking them again for their time and for listening. And that might be old fashioned, but I'm a big believer in handwritten thank you notes because I think that they make an impact, especially in our electronic age. And then I attended our primary precinct caucus, and both Friends and Brand were there present, and Representative Brand came up to me and sought me out because he saw me there and said, oh, thank you so much for the thank you note. I really appreciate that. So that was nice. So those are really the only initial steps that I've taken, but I feel like, as Karen was saying before, that yes, building relationships and having those in place so that when you need to reach out, they already know you're is very helpful. So thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks so much, Beth. Thanks for being with us and for sharing some of your expertise now. I mean, really, as each of us does this work, we turn into sort of the next set of experts, those who know what needs to be done and how it needs to be done. And Beth's now built some relationships there that are really powerful. All right, I am going to move us into what is now some of our like closing remarks and just a couple of pieces as you move forward into your actual advocacy part of the day. So there are many things that NASW Minnesota is doing on the advocacy front every day of the year. And whether it's COVID time or not, or day of the Capitol time or not, this is part of our work plan all of the time. Just a couple things that we do year round that you could join us for if you're interested, or just so you know that they're happening. There's two policy related committees at the chapter. The first is PACE. So that's our political action for candidate election. And this is the group that encourages social workers to run for office and that endorses candidates for office. So this is the committee that interviewed Governor Walz, for example, and decided that we were going to endorse him for office, interviewed Representative Edelson and endorsed her, and we've done that for multitudes of social workers and non-social workers, friends of social workers, people who care about the same things that social workers care about. Those are the people that we're endorsing. So if you are interested in being engaged in that, the people politics part of this whole thing, we would love to have you on our PACE committee. I also want to ask for maybe the first time, some of you, maybe the fifth or sixth or 10th time for some of you, please run for office. All social workers have a voice that needs to be heard. So many of you have what it takes to run for office, to be a voice in this conversation. You met Heather Edelson this morning, you met Peggy Flanagan. There are many people who have run for office. They're just regular old people who know a little bit about a lot of things and could be really good listeners and have what it takes to be a really good lawmaker. So we would love to support you in that effort. And if you decide to do that, please let us know at NASW so we can support you. The second social policy group that we have is our SPAN committee, the Social Policy Action Network. This is the group that sets our legislative agenda, goes to those meetings of all these different policy partners that we have, a few of which you met today, and there's more of them out there that we partner with. And so they keep their pulse on these different issues and what the work of our different policy partners is doing, and then engage our members in that work. So we need more people actively working with our social policy committee. So if it's something you don't have to have solid skills, you don't have to know anything more than what any of us know today sitting on this call, we just need more people engaged in the work. So we'd love to have you there as well. I think the third is to always make sure to tell the chapter what's needed. So don't assume, like all of us say all along, right? Don't assume our clients' needs. Don't assume that NASW knows what you need or that we are doing something about the things that you care about. Let us know what those things are. And several times throughout the year, our members receive different surveys and things from the chapter saying, okay, what do you want us to do about this? Okay, what do you want us to do now that it's COVID-19? We got 125 responses to our most recent survey asking members how to focus our efforts, how what was happening in the world is affecting their practice and how we can be helpful in that. And so that is really helping us focus our efforts. So respond to us, email us, let us know whether Shireen or I or the general admin email, send us your comments and thoughts. All right, and now it's time for action. So folks, here's the deal. If we do a social work day at the Capitol and we meet and we hear from a bunch of policy people and we all get a little bit smarter and we all think about the issues a little bit and then we go off and we do our work, we don't do anything different, and we don't say anything different to our policymakers, we didn't actually have an advocacy day at all, okay? We need to have a real advocacy day. That's why we normally do this as a day at the Capitol, where we're physically at the Capitol, where hopefully that makes it easier for you to walk up and talk to people and see something happen and say some things. So I love that. Let's see something and say something. As our speakers had said today, Heather Edelson said, so, here's what we're asking you to do. We want you to actually lobby your legislators using the tools that were provided today. So look up who your legislators are based on where you live. Who are your folks? Pick some issues that you really care about. You can go through our Google Docs if that's helpful. You can look for resources. You can read things from our policy partners and spend some time lobbying your folks. Now, that doesn't have to be anything fancy. It doesn't have to be a meeting with them. It could be an email. It can be phone calls. You could wait till after 5 o'clock today and leave voice messages if that is more comfortable for you. You can also link with them on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, whatever. Find your folks on those things. You could send a quick note and say, I was at Social Work Day or social online Social Work Advocacy Day, and I'm really passionate about these things and I want you to do something about this. Okay. So whatever sort of hits you personally today in the way that feels good for you to engage in the process, that's what we're asking you to do. So not any specific asks, not any specific ways, you get to decide. The next option for you too is we put together a virtual scavenger hunt, thanks to Sarah on our committee for putting together a virtual scavenger hunt. That is in the Google Docs as well. So if you're a little lost and you're like, I don't even know where to start, I don't know what I want to do, open up that quick little virtual scavenger hunt and it'll walk you through a bunch of ideas for ways that you could just do some things today to get engaged. The next thing I want you to do is report back what you did to us. And so there is a link in the Google Docs and I'm going to put it up here on the screen for you. Oh, look, I had slides for next steps. So here's your next steps, things that you could do. Talk to your legislators, do our scavenger hunt, go into our Google Docs and find all of the resources. And then at the bottom here, it says there's feedback survey URL. That is the document that you can open and it will give you the information to complete this little online survey for us. So fill out our online survey. And that'll do a few things. It will ask some questions, giving us some feedback and opinions about the event and what you'd like us to see us do differently in the future, that sort of thing. It will also give you an option to request CEUs. So those of you who are looking for CEUs for the morning, we actually went till 11:40 now. So we're gonna give you 2¾ CEUs. We'll get that switched up for you here. And then any time that you spend advocating today and doing research on the issues that you care about, looking at the Google Docs and that sort of thing, you can count those as independent study CEUs also. And remember, in this current cycle for your license, you can count all of your CEUs as independent study, or can be done virtually. So you can go ahead and do as much time as you want to doing research and advocating and that sort of thing. You count those as independent study CEUs. And then in that same survey, you can report back to us the advocacy actions that you took today. And if you submit your survey by the end of day today, so we'll say like midnight tonight, but we're not gonna look at it till midday tomorrow. So by morning tomorrow, if you wanna go in and complete the survey and tell us what you did for advocacy work, we will enter you into a drawing. And at noon tomorrow, we are going to do a drawing for some fun prizes and we will mail those out to folks. So the link to that survey is on your screen here. We will put that survey, I think it's already up in the chat. So go ahead and complete that and we'll know what you did. You'll be able to give us some feedback for next time and you'll potentially get some prizes. So that's awesome. So in closing, I want to thank you all for joining us for our 2020 Social Work Online Advocacy Day from NASW Minnesota. I want to thank all of our presenters for being with us today and to all of our committee members for making this a really first ever online advocacy day. I just have to say, as an executive director, as a person that does, you know, puts on a lot of events and works with a lot of partners, this was a really fantastic event from my perspective. There are still over 600 people on the call throughout our time this morning. We had upwards of 800 and it flexed between 700 and 800 throughout our morning here. And the tech worked and you could see us and hear us, I hope. We didn't hear many comments that was a problem. So I have to say this was a really fantastic online advocacy day. I wanna thank everyone for being with us, for being a part of it, for rolling with the changes that the chapters had to put together. We are doing our best to bring events and information and things to you in ways that you can hear them and see them and do something about them and we can be continuing to work on your behalf. So thank you so much for being with us today. I encourage you to do this advocacy work now, today, and into the future. And I look forward to seeing you next year at Social Work Day at the Capitol and in the days and weeks ahead. All my best to you folks. Have a fantastic day. Bye, folks.